All right, today's about to be a big day, chat. Today is a big day. Today is a big day. Why are you opening Edge? Yo, Edge is where it's at. I should call off of work. Yeah, you should. Today's a big day. Wait, you're working on a Sunday? Why? Why are you working on a Sunday? You're also working on a Sunday? Yeah, but I work like basically like every day. I'm big pace. My job doesn't have a 9-to-5. It has a press start streaming. Wait, Yamato got banned? What did Yamato... No, he didn't. What do you mean Yamato got banned? No, he didn't. You're lying. La 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 la. Wait, I was making my meme. That's what I was doing, chat. My meme. I forgot. Let me make my meme. Let me finish my meme. Bro, I'm so funny. Actually, I'm not that funny. Am I funny, chat?
Quarterfinals for one last time, live from the Sajik Indoor Gymnasium in Busan, South Korea. Today is such a big day because
today is a
huge
day.
LCK's very last chance at the World Championship as T1 takes on the LPL's LNG and Scout, as we see him there.
Today is going to be a banger.
Spot in the semifinals. It's going to be such a huge mountain.
Yo, sleeping box, thanks for the 10 gifted, bro.
How difficult it will be to get to the finals, but it also starts right here. They can't drop the ball down now.
I know, it's going to be so much pressure on them though to try and keep those LCK hopes alive, to try and keep the pride of their region there. But I mean, it kind of feels poetic in a way that mantle does fall to T1.
Baker, please, you're our only hope. Baker won Kenobi. He's the only thing standing between us and a full LPL semifinals.
Crazy.
Baker!
I'm here at the desk for this day with Emily, with Dagda, and with Kobe. I think depending on where you fall on the spectrum of fandom, right? There's millions of LPL fans who'd be very
He's going to get to the finals. I can feel it. He's going to lose to the Shy at the end, but he's going to make it to the finals.
Team, hopefully against all of them. It's just too good. How did we get here? Well, yesterday, JDG played KT, and we had someone very invested right next to me. But unfortunately, it was
I need some food. I'm hungry as fuck.
So, I mean, this...
I didn't
and
eat.
As we watch Night with this like massive pop blossom, for anyone that doesn't know, I'm a KT fan, and while I am used
what is
to
this, is this
you
good?
Think I'd be used to the heartbreak.
Is that good?
But, you know, I still feel a little bit
white
about
cookie.
It. I do think honestly, like, I thought we were going to a game five, and then this play
really? Are you
happened.
Lying?
You know, Ruler just absolutely pops
bro,
off.
Bro, what is that? That's
this,
not a cookie. It lied.
It
really sticks.
Cool to see from JDG.
What do you mean,
I mean
cookie?
JDG
that's a lot of bollocks, bro.
A strong.
Yo, I ain't eating that.
Team.
I want the cookies. That's
they,
a best
I do
piece
think
of shit,
you
bro.
Showed. You they showcased in this
what
matchup
else what else
why they are considered such massive tournament favorites.
I do think, though, the KT did themselves proud. I think they did an incredible job yesterday of, like, in-game number one, having that split push composition, out team fighting JDG
Yo,
with that style.
Gourmet truffle mustard like crisps. So are we talking? What are we talking? Mustard?
KT put up
bro, who eats mustard?
Showing against the tournament favorites.
Doesn't make it feel better.
My favorite part, too, about the last game is that we do so many segments where we're deep diving. JDG are the masters of team fighting. Look how they peel for their magnificent carries. Everyone's blocking for them, creating space. That last fight was just Ruler and Knight.
Yes.
There was no peeling. There was nobody creating space for them.
Yeah, KT was creating space. Yeah.
That was true. The vision control was creating space. And the funniest thing to me, you know, we're always looking at the mechanics and everything, but Knight also,
not bad.
He picked the Dark Star skin for Orianna, which makes it purple like Syndra.
Oh.
And hiding the Orianna ball, like all these little things to min-max. I love trying to squeeze out those little advantages.
Yeah, and JDG were the biggest favorites, and they still are. We saw that other teams, of course, dropped out. We saw the bracket
kind
just
of
a second ago. Gen.G didn't make it, but we have JDG remaining. I do want to take a look at a graphic we've shown a couple of times already in terms of the LPL versus the LCK. Historically, why...
What is this link?
I got my one.
Oh. The fuck is that?
English, but he also did a ton of translations, and I worked with him as a journalist.
I know K1, but what is he saying?
So the FPX year, about just the mentality of a lot of LPL teams. And I think one thing that I will absolutely credit LPL teams for, especially in their scrim environments, is they are not afraid to make mistakes. Like, there was a point in the LPL where, like, scrims were actually so crazy that there might not have been a lot you could glean from them in terms of improving. And that's changed since then. But I do think that attitude of, like, we are willing to make mistakes and learn from them and not get bogged down by them is really instrumental in a lot of these matches, especially when there is a lot of pressure, because you see an LPL team make a mistake and you'll notice that a lot of these teams, they will not actually get fazed by it, and they will still try incredibly high risk, high reward plays going forward in that same match.
I love this point too, because
you ignored my donut. What did you say? So I stayed up all night for EU for this big pace. Let's go, Daddy Caedrel. We windows T1 fighting.
Specific things to
yeah,
practice.
Listen.
But
I'm gonna be honest.
Teams go into scrims to
I will be biased
to
T1 today.
Piece. They don't tell you about it, and they like.
If you're an LNG fan, I get it. I'm also a bit of an LNG fan. I love LNG. And don't give away. I love Garland and Scout, but I need.
Kind of lends itself
I think Worlds
think
is going
to
be a bit shit if LNG win. I'm sorry. It's just
like,
true.
Hey, look, we
LNG, JDG, I've seen it before. Weibo, BLG. BLG, JDG final. Come on.
It's kind of catching people off guard. You're not expecting them to be in the positions they are.
For T1 win. Just to spice it up. I want to see T1 JDG. I want to see it. LNG, I'm sorry. It's not you. It's me.
And take the blame, but to potentially make that game winning fight as well.
Yeah, and I think the other thing that I'll highlight about LPL teams specifically is a lot of times when we look at how they're choosing their fight.
Whoa, I'm
doing
this.
Okay,
don't show that.
Why are you fighting over nothing? That's not how any of these teams see it. They're always fighting for something. They're fighting
for
cooldowns.
That's a jump scare to T1 fans.
Around item spikes and that specific stuff. So that's another thing I think I can credit.
That's a happy
LPL
Halloween picture.
Specifically for and the way they see the game.
And I think it's only really we're starting to see that now, because if you look at what's on your screens at the moment, this time last year it was a very different story. We had one LPL team that was in there, those JDG. And immediately they got knocked out in semis by T1. I think
bro,
it's
so
kind of
true.
A long, drawn-out combat to get to the position that they're in, where they are learning.
That's the best meme ever.
They're taking all the learnings that they had from last year and now implementing them this year.
Yeah, LCK was so good. The meta also played such a big part in it. Last year, you know, the Akali Silas meta, they had the master of it, and they made it all the way through. And then this year, meta's been pretty stable. sucks for JDG and Iron Sharpens Iron in the LPL. Having JDG, this super team there, to actually lead the way is definitely benefited.
Yeah, and we'll see if it comes to fruition, because there is still one LCK team there we'll start talking about in just a second. But a
Send
bit of a
meme.
Lighter tone to kind of set
I put
the
it on
mood
my Twitter.
And maybe tell some of the stories of our teams and our players in a different way. We're going to play a game called Blind Pick. It's basically Who Is It, if you've played that before. So I'm going to write something on the whiteboard. Do you want to start, Kobe?
Fine, sure.
And then you have to guess, and you can only ask.
Okay.
What you have
this?
To guess
11, what? 11-0-3. What have you written down? Okay.
Huh?
You've written out 11-0-3.
That's notes for later.
Okay.
They don't exist anymore. I'm sorry.
You're going to have to remember it.
What is she drawing?
I am.
Ooh, okay. Okay.
So explain what you're doing. You're writing down
I'm
a player
I'm writing down
name.
A player. You don't know, and you can only ask yes or no questions, and you have to get it.
Okay.
Yes.
Is my player playing today?
No.
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 Not playing today. Does my player play a carry role?
Kind
of. He does.
Oh, yeah, he does, yeah.
Is my player a top laner?
No.
No.
A jungler?
Yes. Yes.
Is it a North American player?
No.
No.
Oh, no. It's not playing today. Peanut?
No. Come on, think about your question.
It's too hard. I give up.
Oh my god. The thing is, I would want to use the joke about choking, but you didn't choke this
yet.
You
just, so you just gave up.
That was okay. A good one.
Okay. Give it back. Oh, yes.
Here you go.
Is this permanent marker? Or?
No, we're good. It's
okay,
marker.
We're good. Okay.
I'm afraid.
Bro, mustard crisps are weird. They're disgusting.
Don't look
she
at
wrote
that.
Chovy.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I'm going to put it here.
No.
So
oh,
you guys can
smart.
See, but I don't. I have no idea what's going on.
All right, that is smart, actually.
Okay, is it. Do they play on the top side of the map?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. Are they a top laner?
Yes.
Okay. Just in case, could be jungler still. Are they playing today?
No.
No. Okay. Are they from the LPL?
No.
No.
Are they from the West?
Yes.
Yes.
Are they from the LEC?
No.
No.
Okay.
Come on. It's only people in quarterfinals, so.
Yeah.
Oh, it's only people in quarterfinals.
Yeah.
Oh, cool. Is it Dokla?
Yes.
God, sorry. I was blanking for a second.
The pressure's on.
I know. I start sweating.
I don't understand.
I forgot we had a blindfold, but whatever. I'm such a bad game master.
You're running this game.
Yes. So Dokla actually got it. So if you get it faster and less questions, you get
a
crown.
I am running this game.
A crown.
How many questions did he have?
Six.
Nailed
it. We time the pace, chat. We time the pace.
Gonna destroy
all right. No,
I'm not.
Really good at these games.
All right.
Okay.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Do I play on the bot side of the map?
Yes. Yes.
Am I a support?
No.
No.
Am I playing today?
Yes.
Yes.
Am I Gumayushi?
No.
No. There's one other now.
Am I Gala?
Yes.
Oh, clean.
Oh, and that was five, so you win.
That was quick.
Oh, yay.
You get the crown.
Is this going to stay on my head?
No.
It does? Okay.
I want it to stay for the entirety of countdown.
Yeah.
Amazing. Thank you all for
it's
playing.
Probably going to fall off. But
easy clapper.
We'll see.
A well-needed bit of brevity before we get back into
is
the
that a
story
Burger King hat?
And that is mostly about how for T1, the task ahead of them is absolutely monumental. Only LPL team, starting with LNG today.
What
if
is
you
this
get through
paging?
That, well, then you get to play JDG. So it's just insane, Kobe.
Honestly, yeah. But you have to think one step ahead, okay?
Okay.
Just focus on today. It can be daunting looking at the entirety of the top end of the LPL. But one step at
Hey, that's my Twitter!
I love the faker Photoshop.
Yeah, it's
from
great.
LS.
It's amazing. When it comes to T1, though, as you said already, Dokla, it is kind of poetic that it is
I'm
T1,
on the broadcast. Mom!
I think it also kind of shows how big the expectations always are on this roster. Even though they have done very well with this iteration of the roster, it isn't enough until they win a world championship, until they win an MSI.
Yeah, and it's a bit heartbreaking to see how many of those finals they have got to. I mean, if Faker makes it to this one, it's his sixth international final. No, all right, world finals even coming into this. So I think there's a huge amount of pressure to try and perform and be at that level, especially when you are that final LCK team. And you get to see it here on your screens. I mean, 2017, they hit finals, lose to Samsung Galaxy. Last year,
bro, he is going.
In what was supposed to be the moment for T1, they fall short just again. And now they
now
need to make
going.
It the full distance if they hope to hold on to those LCK hopes.
And yeah, one thing you will note there is that T1 have actually
Faker,
never
I'm sending
been
you my energy.
By an LPL team.
Take my energy!
A knockout round like this. that is also by virtue of the fact that this is the first year we finally had none of those like team kills lined up in quarterfinals. But I do
take Kellen's energy too.
Statistic to bring in as we look over Faker's extensive world championship history.
I don't remember the year unless I remember the memes like the broccoli or the head roll on stage or whatever. But it is crazy to see, and that Faker is still so much at the center of this lineup.
Bro,
and
Faker, thing about I hate people that say Faker's not the GOAT.
Eliminated by an LPL team, Faker has never gone out in quarterfinals. Mm-hmm. He has always at least got into semifinals.
He's played nine worlds and he's finished top four in nine world championships. He's finished top four or eight. Like, how mental is that?
That I watched, and they were saying
he's never finished below semis.
They didn't really think that this was not their time. They thought this was their time. That he even thought, can it be this easy? And that
holy
that was a
Faker
huge comeback down to earth for T1, but maybe a good way not to stay complacent. And I see Faker is trying to get in the zone.
He's meditating.
Everyone thinks he's meditating, but he's actually like, if you have the audio, and it's like.
And you give them the expectations of any other org or any other players, then they would be like, we're wildly successful. But this team has only won the one trophy that was spring LCK right when they were put together. They really need that capstone before the team breaks up. It's
I saw a thread, so and it was like, who's the best AD carry ever? And people were saying Ruler, if he wins Worlds.
Yeah, and the interesting discussion this spring,
but someone had a really interesting take.
Of their kind of
someone said
of
Gala.
These
and I thought about it, and I was like, if Gala wins Worlds this year,
this team, if you look at the breadth of their performances,
he's up there, because that means he would have two MSI titles, a Worlds title, and a, I don't know how many LPL titles. Bang is up there, yeah, Bang. But Gala, if he wins Worlds, is like he shoots up there. He has two LPL, two MSI, and then he would have a world title. That's actually crazy. I didn't think about Gala being up there.
We have a heartbreak timeline. We did that yesterday also already. It was a tier list then, but
I want to be honest. Stop saying Uzi. He won nothing. He won MSI. That's it.
That often in these cases where they made the runs to finals, we didn't really consider
He came close to winning a lot of things, but he didn't actually win anything really.
Yeah, and I think
other than a couple of LPLs and MSI.
Back to being T1 and how they just haven't quite been able to get it across the finish line. I think they've been world class for so long, and every time
still better than you. I'm not saying, bro, shut up.
How many of those games are going the full distance to those five games? And it's just at that last little hurdle that they end up falling. And I think that's
who's the best Chinese AD carry though.
I feel like capstone on this.
It's probably Jackie Love
on this team. To be able to find that success would be a wonderful thing to find.
Best Chinese AD, Jackie Love Agala.
Organization's history. This is a team that once you join it, there's a monumental amount of pressure, regardless of what you've accomplished, right? Like, this is South Korea's team. This is by far and away the most popular team. We've been going to a coffee place near the pop-up store in the mall, and it's always jam-packed. Like, today there was a line winding all the way up the stairs. So, I mean, I cannot understate just how massively popular
the crowd is
going
to be full today.
How already, even if we don't include everything,
look at that they're showing on the broadcast. The crowd loves it.
Definitely so many storylines going into today, not in the least in the mid lane, because today the GOAT and his former students are finally meeting in a world's knockout stage as Faker and Scout are facing off in our featured matchup presented by Mercedes-Benz.
The last quarterfinal is about to get started, and what better way to close it out than to have two Worlds-winning mid laners meet in our featured matchup presented by Mercedes-Benz. The two have crossed paths a lot over the years, but it's been a long time since they met in an elimination game.
Bang goes out, gets ulted back. Oh wait, they did play. Oh no, that's just group stage. They never played a best of five against each other.
Initially, the student Scout joined T1 as a substitute in 2015 under Faker's wing.
SKT will be your first ever two-time world champions!
Before eventually carving his own path in history, lifting the Summoner's Cup with EDG in 2021.
Aiming, trying to put the damage down as Scout is going to join the fray. From the side, it's a five, man!
But one trophy isn't enough to overtake
Scout,
Faker's legacy.
Giga Chad.
And Scout can prove here and now that the student has taken another step to becoming the master, sending his former teammate home.
I love the stage setting by Atlas there in that piece about how there's such a big legacy, but it does mean it means nothing if you can't make it true on the day, especially
red versus blue.
Scout, who's been playing lights out this tournament so far.
Yeah, one thing I want to stress about Scout is that sometimes you have all-pro votes that you're kind of like, I don't know about this, you know, and this year, or this summer rather, Knight got the first team all-pro mid laner, but Scout got MVP, and he's actually now a two-time MVP on the year, which is just showcasing how instrumental his performances are to this LNG's team's success.
And I think a lot of Chinese fans in the LPL finally feel like Scout is getting the success and the recognition that he deserves. When you look back to over the last couple of years, I mean, the guy's a world champion, but we haven't really seen him getting the MVPs or getting those moments to shine.
Story-wise,
he's one of the favorites of those LCK imports.
I don't know if Scout will. If Faker ever retires, how iconic would it be if he went into coaching and then Scout joined T1?
Holy. Which is cool. But yeah, he has been so instrumental to this region, dedicated to EDG, now coming across to LNG. It feels like he's trying to not only cement that legacy that he created on EDG, but now create a new one on this LNG roster.
Stats are useless.
So
I don't give a fuck.
He's so versatile for this LNG team because, you know, he plays the Nico in his big initiation, but he also plays the classic mages, could be the hard carry for them later. And it has been magnificent to see him on this world stage continue his very strong performances. In the first 2 days, he was
But the sample size is not great.
On his back-to-back Azir games, only dying a single time in both of those.
Strength of schedule, champs you're playing. It can all be really situational.
And he's been really upfront
games you played.
How much he's actually learned from Faker, not only studying underneath him, but then just continuing to watch him from.
Okay, will Gala get Kai'Sa?
And I think the crucial thing that I really appreciate about Scout in terms of his evolution as a mid laner is how much he does pay attention to side lanes, like you said.
The roster's being shown on screen, everyone loses it.
He looks at the map and sees where he can make plays for his team, and that is why he's just such a huge piece of LNG winning games.
The mid lane has been very important, as it always
will
is.
Will Scout get Azir?
Get into those late game team fights and what you want to achieve.
I think Azir's banned.
So I wanted to look at the champion pools of both these mid laners.
I think Azir Orianna is hot contest.
And as we see it there, the only champions Faker
I mean, this is doing Faker dirty because he mains Nico and he plays a lot of Ahri. So as much as he hasn't played them at Worlds, he played them so much in LCK. Also, his Akali, he plays Akali.
Want to try and take more of these early fights, look for the early skirmishes, and that's where we got to see things like the Sylas, the Ahri, the Nikos coming to the forefront in that mid lane so they can play for those early aggressive picks.
So I think the thing is, Faker really likes Nico.
Because they're so strong in those early
Faker really likes
Sometimes those types of graphics can be
he hasn't played it yet at Worlds, though.
Faker. He's been playing League of Legends
forever.
Yeah. He has played so many champions in the mid lane. And even though, you know, Nico that was up there under Scout was a huge part of him getting T1 here, Faker utilizing that and the Azir mainly.
Absolutely. I guess the added context here.
I feel like, imagine
Faker
the pressure that T1 is under. If KT
season,
weren't knocked out
back,
and they were playing today and KT was playing tomorrow, I think the pressure would be a bit less.
Right?
But,
they
are under so much pressure.
Further on in time,
if they don't win this,
the
everyone in Korea is going
to
hate them.
But it is important to discuss how important he just is to this lineup. And you might say, in today's head-to-head matchup, he might not be stronger than Scout, but his importance to T1 is so huge.
Yeah, he's such a huge voice for this team. Here we see their game record.
All right, by the way,
summer.
I'm sorry if you're here.
Striking thing.
You might have had a lot of ads in the last 30 minutes, but they're done now. I ran all the ads, and you're not going to get any ads now. I'm sorry, I ran them all early. I tried to sneak them all in quickly before anything happened, so now you won't get any ads, okay? So I'm sorry if you had a lot of ads in the last half an hour, but I was sneaking them all in, and they're done now. No more ads, done. All up until past the next game, done. No ads.
It came at a pretty
good
time.
So hopefully that's a bit better.
Started to question, does Faker still have it? You know.
And you can't, bro. You can't call me sellout Pog off. If I was sellout Pog off, I would run them when the most people were here to make the most money. I don't care. I just want to push them back so you don't get hit by them.
Of some of the top mid laners we have in the world.
I pushed them at like when we had like 8k viewers. They're all basically done now. You also won't get. You also shouldn't get what's it called? Pre-roll ads either.
That just showcases a kind of a an omnipresence that Faker
Yeah, I have
has,
a contract with Twitch, and they auto-run, but I can control them a bit.
But all five players have to perform if you want to win a match.
Run them before
here
the tees? No, I don't need to. We're done.
After they locked their spot in the knockout stage about their confidence moving forward.
I think some people, like, haven't... They click start streaming, and then they spam ads within the first, like, half an hour of their stream. And then it buffers everything. That's like the hack. Tarzan or owner? I'm gonna be honest, I think Tarzan was having a... Tarzan was playing a bit meh so far. Tarzan hasn't been playing amazing. He had one really good game against KT and one really good game against JDG. He's been alright, actually. He's been alright. He just had a couple bad games, I guess. It's just sticking in my head.
T1 fighting, indeed. Guma feels that they can do it, and that's what you have to believe. And we've talked
belief,
about
that's what we need, chat. Just fucking South, believe. Get your fucking South balls Korea, out and say it with your chest.
The job they
don't
have
be like, ah,
oh,
I hope T1 win.
No slouches.
They're gonna win, okay? Manifest that shit.
Underrated when you look at the latter season, I think, in the LPL, but they shut up a lot of people.
I think that
don't be a half-ass. Don't be a pussy. Say it with your fucking chest. You believe it's gonna happen. They're gonna win. They're gonna play against JDG. They're going to beat LNG. We're not gonna have an LPL 4 team winter fucking playoffs, though. No.
A lot of people are looking at the likes of EDG coming
T1 will say
that
no.
That went to Worlds, and then it was only after we got to see them pop off in playoffs, push JDG.
They're gonna fucking do it.
Every single time these two teams have faced off, that people started to say LNG is actually the second seed from the LPL, and across the board, this roster is looking to nearly create a new.
I mean, LNG is really good. I don't want to disrespect LNG. I will never shit talk them. I think LNG is one of the best teams in the world. But I just can't. I don't want four LPL teams. I'm sorry.
King over in the LPL because he had the highest transfer fees of any player in the LPL
I can't
this
do it.
Year to come across to LNG. They really wanted this top laner. Didn't quite work out in spring, but over the course of summer, he has looked spectacular and playing multiple different styles here.
Yeah, and I think the big thing with LNG is that you would think of them as a slower team compared to other LPL teams. That's not to say that they're a slow team. The LPL is a very fast-paced region, and as we look at how they perform, like versus other, in comparison to the averages from other LPL teams, I think the big thing for me is that first blood time, they're a lot less bloody early, in my opinion. But I do think what was instrumental in them going up
okay, here's the tweet.
GDG and actually pushing them to those five games was
it's a funny tweet if you want to laugh it's a funny tweet and now we're ready to get into the game.
Did try
holy fuck
to
I'm pumped
scrap with them a lot
are you guys excited
than what you
oh I'm excited
what you saw from LNG
even Zika versus Zeus sounds great
timer, that's the big one. I mean, 840 on the
first every matchup is crazy
for me is always the standout. That seems to be where they want to go for these fights and
this is a world semifinals. Let's be honest, I feel like this isn't a quarterfinals. This is a semifinals. This is top four in the world
to see where that feeling is coming
this is
from
top four.
People because
T1, LNG, JDG, Weibo Gaming.
But
top four teams in the world.
To T1,
in
T1
reverse order.
Had longer
Weibo's first.
Game times, but that's only because their game times in losses.
This chat still thinks Weibo's going
so
to lose. Who's
going to
win, Weibo or BLG? Say it.
Behind.
Say it
LNG
with your chest. Go on, say it.
Quickly,
let me see it. I'm going to screenshot
slowly.
All the BLGs.
T1 had much quicker times when they're actually winning the game, instantly being able
you're
to close it out.
You're dumb as fuck.
And push for that, so...
Yo, Weibo believers,
to LNG
when we win,
and
just laugh at chat.
When
I'm going to get you a special
the game,
emote to laugh at them with when they're in the World
way,
Finals, Weibo.
You know, pushing for
I'll get you something special. I'll get
it's
you a little present.
Explosive.
Because you're a real
shiny,
one.
But they get the job done.
They get the job done, and when it comes to the team fight, they will be on point as well. And I believe you wanted to take a look at a T1 team fight, Toby.
Right. I think something that's going to be very, very fun for this matchup is going to be the draft phase because we've seen some slight changes.
I bet $100 on LNG and I'm a T1 fan, so it's win-win.
Now, of course, everybody is well aware of the Senna Tahm Kench, and I'm not going to use the T1 example of the Senna Tahm Kench the first game versus BLG because that's not fair. They got a huge lead, level one. I'm going to use a harder example. This is a game where T1 are 2,000 gold behind, a dragon behind to BLG.
Owner's team fight here was insane.
So you can't say I'm cherry picking something where they're super far ahead with this Tahm Kench, but Tahm Kench absolutely counters single target dive. The Syndra, the Vi that have been very important, and even to some extent, the Alistar here. So we're gonna take a look at how expertly they use Karia's Tahm Kench, even without the Senna, to be able to protect Gumayushi here. The first thing they do is in these team fights they're forcing around Dragon while they're behind, is they create this triangle to protect the back line. So Karia has distance to be able to protect both of the carries, either Faker or Guma. And you notice Guma's position here is on the front line. He can only do that because they have a Tahm Kench, and it allows him to put this auto attack threat onto the enemy jungler that is going to be coming for this dragon to be able to get that first kill and get excited. So that's the game plan from T1 side. And
oh,
you see it play out here. Yeah. Boom, boom, boom. They take him down, and they're going to get a bunch of damage onto the enemy jungler. But what BLG are thinking from their play side is that they're going to have on engage onto Gumayushi here and headbutt him into Yagao so they can use this Syndra ultimate, burst down the Jinx, right? Seems like a great game plan.
Yeah.
Too bad Tahm Kench is here. Karia is going to deny the whole plan, and it would have worked out because both DPS for BLG are right here to hit Guma. But the Scatter of the Weak is completely nullified there. He eats him up, and Guma pops right back out, excited, and they
owner
chase down these
it.
Kills. Even from a 2,000 gold and dragon deficit, and Gumayushi goes on in this game to end 11-0-3 with that protection from Karia. So really want to see the diversity that we can see in dragon
owner, baby.
Explored here in this series.
Yeah, and
get excited, chat. Get excited.
Karia's Tahm Kench specifically, because it's not just for protection. Like in that fight, he plays this so aggressively and so forward. It's one of
his signature give them energy.
His third most played, 71.8% win rate. And I think with the meta that we've seen LPL teams bring,
bro, Karia's had a haircut. He's looking fresh.
They're comfortable in that style, but it will left to be seen if they will be able to play it today. Let's check in with our fans and who.
Oh, Zeus almost fell over.
Who is going to win in our MasterCard fan predictions each day? You can head over to MasterCard.
I want to hear the announcement for the teams. When they go T1,
whoa,
everyone's going to scream.
What?
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 Is that correct?
That's bugged. That's bugged. That is so bugged.
A mistake.
Oh, it is. Oh, and we're not saying this in terms of kind of
that's
how
bugged.
We think this match will go, but in terms of kind of the fan backings that we've seen on X
that,
so far. Right?
What the fuck? That's so bugged. Oh, there we go. Fixed. When they announce the teams, I hope they clap for LNG. Please clap for LNG, Korean crowd. Don't do them dirty. And they're the LPL third seed, LNG!
Their hopes and dreams of all the fans in the LCK.
Don't
they
do that.
Rely on the flagship organization of T1 with such a tough road ahead of them of LPL super teams. They will need to perform to their absolute peak. Will
Shocks nail it, get the zero, nail it for
all
0 seconds.
LPL teams have done so far. Will LNG do it once and for all today, or will the hometown favorite make the crowd erupt? Let's kick off this quarterfinal.
Holy shucks, bro, she nails those timers. She's crazy. You can see her look to the left to see the timer. Bro, it's actually really hard to do that.
We'll have to start again next year.
This is the one, this is a sick teaser, by the way. This teaser is crazy. Everyone get your blankets ready. Everyone get your teas and coffees. Get cozy.
Scout. 2015년 SKT의 연습생이었던 그는 멀리서 그의 우상인 페이커의 롤드컵 우승을 지켜보았습니다. 2016년 페이커의 서브가 된 그는 아쉽게도 그의 그림자에서 벗어날 수 없었죠. LPL에서 새로운 기회를 얻은 스카웃. 끊임없는 노력 후 2021년 롤드컵을 들어올립니다. 2023년 그는 고향인 한국에서 LNG와 함께 운명적으로 페이커와 대결하게 됩니다. 그들의 첫 다전제 경기죠.
상현경은 선수로서 좋은 마인드셋을 가지고 오랜 기간 동안 좋은 성적을 낸 게 정말 존경받을 만한 선수인 것 같고 선수로서의 책임감 같은 게 많이 느껴져서 그런 부분을 좀 따라하려고 했던 것 같아요. 2021 World Champion, the MVP in the LPL
regular season, an absolute force. 스카 선수는 예전부터 게임에만 집중하고 굉장히 조용한 선수였는데 그 덕분에 지금은 최고의 선수가 되었고 다시 맛보게 되었습니다. 스카 선수랑 굉장히 오랜만에 다시 만나게 됐는데 얼마나 성장했을지 기대가 되고 빨리 맛보고 싶습니다.
这也是我就是因为我之前的成绩都是八强嘛，所以在八强的时候再度击败就是去年季报的这个对我来说非常有意义。你们22年釜山的噩梦将在这里重现。 我们会让这里再度鸦雀无声。
서로의 이기고 지고 하는 과정에서
Faker did get injured. They are on a 4 loss streak.
서로의 속마음을 털어놓는 시간들도 있었고 100%의 T1도 보실 수 있을 거라고 생각합니다.
정혁이
형, 지금 저는 많이 성장했으니까 지금의 저를 느껴보세요.
예찬아, 다시 만나서 반갑다. 최고가 되려면 저를 넘어서야 할 겁니다.
Team remaining outside of the LPL from any region.
This is the team that T1 fans want at the World Championship.
Gala will not have it! LNG make their way into the quarterfinals!
8강의 마지막 날, 이제 시작합니다.
상혁이 형, 미안하지만 제가 올라가겠습니다.
예찬아. 행운을 빈다.
Holy fuck.
멋지게 싸우자.
I'm ready! I'm ready! I'm ready! No, I'm ready! I'm ready! Start the game! Start it up! Okay, now clap for LNG in the intro, please. Don't be weird. Just a little bit. Just...
마지막 대결이 펼쳐질 이곳 부산에 오신 여러분 환영합니다. 오늘 경기에 나설 두 팀을 맞이할 시간입니다. 먼저 여러분이 너무나도 잘 알고 있는 미드 정글
Golden Sick flew to Korea.
그리고 오늘도 갈라쇼는 계속된다.
Oh, it's LNG.
LNG.
Nice. They clap. They clap. Respect. Respect. Now here
Hello,
comes the.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Busan for our final clash of the quarterfinals. Please join me in welcoming our two seeds to the stage with the jungle mid duo known to everyone here in Busan and the unstoppable Gala in the bot lane. It is LNG.
Here comes big pace for T1.
이어서 챔피언이라는 타이틀이 너무나도 잘 어울리는 팀이죠. LCK의 마지막 희망.
이제요
팀. Here comes. 노린다.
카스터 윤.
A team synonymous with championships, looking to raise the Summoner's Cup for the fourth time, none other than T1!
남은 자리는 단 하나뿐! 마지막으로 4강에 오를 팀은 어디가 될지! LNG와 T1의 대결 지금부터 시작하겠습니다!
Woo! That's right! That's right! He just said just about to see a banger!
In the semifinals,
that's what he said! Don't forget!
Let the battle begin! Here we are on the caster desk, and I gotta say, it's hard to fall off Caster Jun.
because he's such a legend that he just goes completely off script. Then I stick to the script because I don't want to mistranslate. And this man is clearly saying the most hype stuff imaginable. Regardless of what language you speak, you can tell what he's saying is probably dope. It's just a hard act to follow. That's all I'm saying.
Has like 5 words. The Caster Dune talks for two minutes.
Yeah. Has
don't
Drake
worry,
Adler gone.
Said it best yesterday. He's given up on trying to follow up. Caster John, what an intro. And I got to say, of all the quarterfinals, I think this is on paper the one that is going to feel the closest. We've had some great series, but I think this one might top it all.
This one is going to be so good. I'm this so ridiculously excited.
Who has side selection?
Welcome to you as well. This is your
thanks.
Intro,
good to
Dracos.
Be here. Yeah, Dracos, Chronicler,
on the
and Azale for the cast. Thrilled to be here, gentlemen, and thrilled to be here for this game. Can't wait to see you.
LNG blue side. Oi, oi, oi. All right, what are the bans? Caitlyn Renata. Ooh, anyway, Zaya ban. Now, the two big champs I'm thinking of are Nico and Azir and Rumble. Okay, Nico ban. Nico, Azir, Rumble are the three champs I'm looking at. Them. Now, there's Rumble. Now, what's the last one?
I wouldn't be surprised if Carrier added more high pressure supports to his arsenal, something that T1 uses really well.
So Azir Orianna's up. They should first pick Jarvan. Anytime. Tarzan's been playing a lot of Jarvan. 100% Jarvan first pick. Now it depends what T1's prio is. You take Azir or Orianna.
That's big. Counter pick, four supports, you know, from these LPL teams that we've seen win in three back-to-back
days. I don't know if they should go Orianna versus Jarvan.
I
hope they play Wukong, but they're playing Rell, so I'm guessing it's Rell jungle, but I really hope it's Wukong. Now, is it Gala Kai'Sa? Jarvan with Zaya ban and Caitlyn ban. You ban Caitlyn for Kai'Sa. Caitlyn ban for Kai'Sa is really good.
That's my biggest question.
And right from the get-go, I like this from LNG. Take away this J4.
Now, I think T1 should not drop AD. I mean, I guess they can. What do they have? They have Jinx, Zeri. No, they don't have Zeri. Gumba doesn't play Zeri. Azir, no shocker. They could pick Aphelios here. Aphelios here could be good. Aatrox.
These are the two champions that
I think they should ban Camille. You know,
with these iconic players, and that is really, really scary.
Camille,
you know, people are generally
could be good ban.
The Azir matchup into Orianna.
Rennington,
kind of
maybe.
A similar thought process to when you're playing against Victor, where you can try to go in on cooldown, force out those flashes, get
repeat
ganks, get the kills. But I will say, at Worlds, most of our Orianna players have been able to play very well around that, and we haven't really seen them fall prey.
What are they playing,
Bob? To that Azir
Nautilus
play.
Ben?
So, interested to see if Scout can really kind of ramp things up. And change that
are they playing Rakan, Rell?
See what T1 do.
Maybe they're playing Rakan on 4.
What are they
I mean, they should ban ADs. I think they should ban Jinx Aphelios. They should ban Jinx Aphelios. They want to play Senatam. Yeah, but you wouldn't ban Nautilus if you're going to play Senatam. You would ban Rakan if you're going
to
play Senatam.
To make sure they're getting something out of this Aatrox pick.
I mean, I think you could just ban Renekton if you're going to ban another top laner, but they might just
if they ban Alistar here, they want Rakan. If they ban Rakan, they want Senatam.
It's obviously a great option. Cassante, you think you're generally
I think if they ban Alistar here, they should ban Rakan. Yeah, okay, they should ban Rakan.
But it's just going to be a focus on supports here. And maybe going to be a
they want Kalista?
For
no way
that
they want Kalista.
Even
you wouldn't ban Alistar really Nautilus kind of if you want Kalista.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised.
You would just pick Kalista on 4 and counter pick support.
The ban here,
you have Rell.
Senna be really successful into
they have to ban Rakan now. Have to.
And there is also
then maybe they can play Senatam.
I'm assuming this Rell will go towards owner. But there is still the opportunity for T1 to hold that until the end.
I mean, clearly they're just trying to limit the engage options to pair with the
they could do Kalista.
Right?
You know, what support do you have?
The emphasis here. The Rell has already been taken away. Again, assuming it's
going to be a Rell.
Jungle, it is a
I mean, I think Senatam, isn't it? They have nothing. What are they going to play?
There are other options still available, but they're
with Rakan ban, Rakan is good into Tam.
Yeah, they have to go Senatam. Which is that support pick on 4. So they self-ban out that Rakan.
I don't know what they pick support now, though.
Now they go over towards
Kai'Sa Braum is trash.
Kai'Sa
Taric is trash.
Kai'Sa
Leona
is
trash.
Teams in the world that has shown us that at a high level.
Specifically, Carrier has been
Pyke, maybe? Pyke could work. I don't know if Hung plays Pyke, though.
On support. And with Senna, it really opens up the pool.
Insta-lock Blitz.
The crank is here.
This is like almost a pre-counter to that
Holy
Tom
shit.
Kench. You're kind of expecting the Tom Kench to come in. People do like this matchup. You can go aggressive. With that Blitzcrank, but this is a Feast or Famine style
especially if
you're
playing Tom.
And he's going to have to perform well because if you
especially
fall behind
if you're playing
a Blitz,
Tom
Kench. You become useless fast.
And this Gwen actually is the counterpick that
Gumba
T1
Cho'Gath.
Opted into.
I don't know, Tom Kench isn't the best here now. They have Gwen Blitzcrank.
We'll
but I think they're
going
to have to go Tom Kench anyway. It ain't the best
here.
Though.
I mean, this
I hope
I'm
they, if they have something else prepared, that would be great because Tom Kench versus these champs is kind
of
shit.
I've seen things like Cho'Gath. Neela is something that I've heard about.
Senna Neela!
it is the Neela Senna lane. This is something that a lot of people have been kind of whispering about.
Okay.
Kind of talking about it.
Okay, let's see it.
Popping up in scrims.
Let's see it. Let's see it.
The ability to all in here is.
All right, don't forget you
really
can use your tier 1 or Twitch Prime to avoid ads for the entire stream for Worlds. You don't have to. There'll be no ads running now, but you can subscribe if you want to avoid them.
A full on Senna support. This is really exciting to see this brought out in such an important
match. I appreciate the support. You can also drop a follow for big pace, but that's it for me. Let's get into it.
In this game with the Neela pick, suddenly this is a must pick ban. Highly contested champion can change the entire structure
pace,
of draft moving forward, but can they execute on it? As highlighted, Neela very feast or famine.
I just bet my life savings on T1.
Yes, but not their traditional yeah. safe.
Go Moth Gamba. Go Gamba. Gamba that shit right fucking now.
Yeah,
holy fuck, I'm hyped.
Something that T1 themselves suffered defeat from.
This is gonna be crazy. This is gonna go crazy.
And it actually was a really big point because that was the point where T1.
Alright, I don't know how this T1 bot lane is gonna play out.
Falter more and more, and after that we did see.
But I guess Neela W can stop Blitzcrank knockup, right?
Played someone in LCK.
I mean, it's so interesting because you know, Senna traditionally you want to pair with melee champions that are farming, and you queue through them for the heal plus the poke at the same time. Neela basically works in the
Where's
same way.
Where's your T1 jersey?
Is essentially
T1 took it away from me. I'm not even kidding.
Right?
They actually took it away from me.
Style, you're going to be between the enemy and your Senna, so the Senna can get that double value, can look for the poke.
I'm not even kidding. They took it.
Well, trying to go aggressive,
I don't have one.
And I'm so interested to see what kind of a build
they took it because they were going to get it,
so
give it to the players
options.
To sign it, so it's gone.
Go things like that are more kind of tanky options, and they just act as like a pseudo engage, the primary engage. You know, what kind of a build is he going to go? That it really remains to be seen.
Something around
all right,
find
big
out
pace.
As we get onto the rift for
Come on, T1.
Here.
Come on, T1. Let's get it, man. Don't fuck it up.
Massive quarterfinal for all of the LCK. The last hope, T1 on the red side versus LNG. Of course, you can connect your League of Legends account with Prime Gaming to grab the exclusive Braum W emote. Get those rewards. Get in there.
And we've already seen Hung actually place an early ward.
I'm
to
a bit
try
nervous.
Control of the brush. Obviously, into any Neela
lane. I'm a bit nervous.
And make sure that you can actually threaten with the Blitzcrank, because if you just let Gumang.
Are they going to level one invade bot side? They have got double range champ and Rell.
Once you get an experience lead, actually retaking control.
Oi, mana flow.
Blitz just has to threaten all ins in basically every Blitz lane ever, right? You yeah. offer nothing other than that. So, especially against a range support like the Senna. Okaria doesn't have to farm. You're just going to be purely focused
they
on
are just
harassing
legit walking
this
in.
Blitz, poking down this Blitz. And
yeah, Tarzan has to give. Rel Q is so broken.
Not able to step up and really make them worried about those hooks, then it's going to be tough, and they're going to use this pressure here. Level one, really strong with both the bot laners there from T1 there to assist. Owner
Three
moves in.
From
he's going to be able to steal away the Raptors and see if he can find anyone on the red. Doesn't see it, so he's
this is really
go
good.
Up
I'm surprised that
buff,
Owner is
like.
Not taking red buff.
Seeing what angle they can find to maybe generate an early.
Why is Owner not taking red?
Done.
He wants Finally to do blue
match,
grump and defend his own top side.
Back to it because it's so interesting because it's such a unique duo of champions, but it's going to be frustrating for side of LNG.
His red buff's gone.
It could be effortless if they find a single all in. If you shut this bot lane down early,
Tarzan did wolves.
Apart. But if you play
Gaara
a slow
defended
lane
it. No, Gaara pulled the red buff
Senna,
to make it look like Jarvan was in the bush,
Neela,
but the red buff reset, so you can see
and yeah, now you
that
can see
they're not actually on it.
Gallen Hung already on the back foot here, not able to walk up. Early level two comes through, courtesy of the experience sharing from Guma as he grabs those creeps and just makes the lane.
Oh, nice ward by Faker. This is going to be a great trade.
We talked about. Oh,
wait, he has to flash. Wait, he's dead.
Oi,
Q's cooldown.
Not going to step too far forward.
Faker can QW him if he walks up.
Excellent start for him in the mid lane.
Yeah, nicely played. Scout just went to the side to try to get a ward down. And
holy
Faker
fuck, Faker. That was a big mistake by Scout.
That he has like his jungler.
Faker's Orianna. Classic.
Knew that he was able to play towards that side. Just chases him down, forces a flash.
At the same time,
absolute
T1
classic.
Aware that Tarzan is somewhere on the top half of the map.
So
right?
Owner needs to go to enemy red. Please don't go to Raptors.
Hasn't been taken, so
please go enemy red, Owner.
Too far forward there and committing his flash. Definitely something that is more risk averse and ends up working out well, though we are
Whoa,
seeing
Scout just used all his mana. He has the base
again.
Now. He
Maybe
took another bad trade.
Gank afterwards. Faker is pretty far up.
Well, and look where Faker is positioning, though. You can see him playing towards the bottom side of this lane. He's going to play towards the side that his jungler is.
Oh, really
he's
nice base timer. Please don't get cancelled by range minions.
The ward up
Please,
on
range
side,
minions,
right
don't hit him.
Your screen, so he's gonna Mamma be able
mia.
To have time to react.
He got the XP from the two minions, too.
Oh, and it's pushing slowly towards him. So Faker will take the base, he'll just TP back in. It's also worth noting that he is playing Comet. We see so many.
I guess the benefit of Owner taking red late means that enemy red buff respawns later and he has it for longer in the early game. So his red buff will respawn faster. So he can use his own red to invade enemy red buff respawn because it's later. It's very, very niche. Very niche play. But his red buff spawns way earlier now. Could be something he did on purpose. I don't know. But that's something that will happen now because of his delayed take.
The play will fizzle out, but topside, bot side.
Wow, he's up 8 CS in this lane.
They're getting to do what he wants on top side of the map, and it is paying off.
He's trying to take the Raptor respawn. I don't know if he's gonna. Did he get it?
This wave comes in, but you can see already that
what? Rel Q? What the fuck is that damage?
Yeah, and I think part of that is Zeus also had to kind of respect the wave. Couldn't take early trades because he knew that Tarzan was towards the top half of the map. So if he trades too aggressively early, and Gwen, the first few levels are actually quite strong. And you set yourself up for a dive.
Man, I think the power of this Neela lane is that the Senna gets so much XP, doesn't she? Look at the XP in bot. Senna is a full level up. It's the Senna will just become really strong.
You can pop your immune. Stay outside where he's still on the outside of that.
They're going to be level 5 at 4 minutes 30.
That. It makes it very, very difficult.
Maybe not on this wave.
Or Aatrox kind of play that style that you want to in these matchups where you're constantly just poking away with those Qs. Because Gwen has the ability, both with that immunity and also with the Skippin' Slash, to dodge to the side, to trade back really effectively.
I like how they're like, Owner, you need to play bot side more. Let's late invade bot and split the map.
I'm so interested to see how
then you can't go top side.
This guy has just improved by leaps and bounds over this last year. In summer especially, I thought he was incredible in the LPL, and there is that style that I'm talking about. Right on the edge, the Q gets immune, and he's going to be able to get a good trade back as a result.
Excellent Q too, though. Oi,
Zeus.
The pullback does come in.
Zeus, be careful. Oh, he saw the ward expire.
We'll get easier once he has some natural sustain to come through from the
Yeah, the Jarvan didn't base yet.
Right now, when running the top side of the map, Owner there just to cover, just to pick up the Krugs.
Yeah, big finger Zeus hasn't actually backed yet. His wave state is kind of awkward, though. I wouldn't be surprised if Owner goes for a lane gank here, but did get spotted. So
Owner level 4 gank.
Shouldn't be in any trouble.
Absolute
least,
classic.
Allow Zeus
always level 4 lane gank top.
And
it's his number one
in,
play.
And then use the teleport to get
he
back
means
to
that play.
Again, I'm pretty sure Owner did get spotted, so shouldn't really be any risk for the Gwen here.
Does always get a little bit dicey, though, you know, when Gwen hits 6 there, because he can try to hold this wave potentially. Owner has base. Obviously, Zika doesn't know this, so he's still going to play down towards river, where we know that Tarzan is available.
Yeah, top's still in a bit of a tough spot. He needs to push out this wave. And
seeing that the wave got pulled with a cannon,
well, Tarzan ran top
base,
from base.
Now Owner
Zeus
is not there. The jungler's coming up, and Zika 6, so they're going to look for an all in.
Zeus. Has the ulti, a bit extra movement speed. Will it get away from the flank drag? Quick flash out to safety. Instantly just going to ult for the extra movement speed.
Gwen can flash.
Now the damage coming through for the Gwen. Tarzan looking to follow up the flash in. Zeus still living for now, but first blood on the top side for LNG.
Oh, yeah, Zeus.
Cuts him down.
Really well played there by
Top
LNG.
Is in a really bad state
Owner
now.
Didn't want to show, so he didn't want to fully
Top is in a really bad state.
To be able to help him crash. As a result, he hides his positioning, but it means that Zeus had to stay around because with that cannon, it was going to be a freeze. Owner will start up the dragon on the bot side here, though, so we'll see. If LNG has anything to say about it.
Really well done there by LNG.
But Faker is gapping, man. What is going on mid?
Wave in the adaptation from Tarzan to, instead of going back, opt towards that topside gank. T1 will be able to pick up the dragon. And I do think
Holy
that
fuck, he's 13 CS up in a zero arena.
Means that at least right now,
does Scout have Hela Blades?
CS and
that might affect his lane a little bit. He's counter jungling. Yo, you're getting really cocky here, Faker. Holy fuck.
Of a level up and has a kill plus a 20 CS lead. So
nice this playing Conqueror.
It's going to be really tough to deal with as we get into the mid to late stages of the game.
I mean, it's first blood as well. So it's nearly an 800 gold lead up there in the top lane, which is going to be really, really rough. But Zeus trading well there. The wave still should crash. It's too much to hold, and you're too low HP. So the wave will crash. Zika's going to go see if he can find some honey fruit, likely, in the river.
This is crazy what's going on.
Which he does. I can see his health going up.
Just the level difference in both is absurd. I think Faker's a bit scared now.
Paying off thus far for LNG and their counter pick with the Gwen. The bottom side, however,
because in a matchup with a Azir Orianna, the jungler doesn't even have to gank through river. He can just gank through the lane. If he's running at you through the lane and Azir shuffles, you have to flash the ult every time. Otherwise, you get pushed back into EQ flash, you're dead.
To see if T1 are able to use.
And it's a good bit of push here for Carrier and Guma. And I want to see, you know, if T1 are going to be opting into.
Yeah, the Neela W versus Blitzcrank E seems quite handy.
You know, trying to follow around your jungler, trying to pick up all these additional souls because really.
They're only 5 CS up bot. I thought they'd be more.
Especially if you are playing purely support Senna.
Owner is just going to start Herald.
You're not going to be kind of getting that additional goal.
I don't know if he's going to get away with that, but the benefit is Faker's way ahead in tempo. Scout didn't even reset yet.
So I want to see how he optimizes mid gap right now. Might get them heralds already, but that is going to be a huge portion of your damage in this kind of a game.
But Blitzcrank might sack. Look at Blitz. Souls,
15
is he coming?
AD, 20 range, 10% crit chance.
No, he thinks he's dead. So he's not sure. He's going back bot. They're going to give. Are they going to give? Scout cancel his base.
Members in the area, ready to set up. Scout on the flank. However, we're going to look for the shove.
Oh, Faker movement was really good there. Oh my God. T1 just smoked them on movement.
That one through. T1 taking one.
Bro, the movement was crazy. Didn't even get knocked up or flash, just runs in a straight line in front of it. Senna ult was really good there too.
In these early skirmishes, the heal as well as the fact that you can take or rather focus on a target with all the CC that is available for T1 with Shockwave.
Well, Faker is actually carrying the whole game right now.
And LNG going a little bit too ham on the early skirmish.
Oh, we might have to flash
absolutely. Just look at the itemization. For
look
the
at this
right
mid.
Like,
what is going on in here?
He's got some mana and a dagger. That's it, right? Like, he doesn't really have much power behind this, so he does find a decent ultimate, but the follow up is not going to be there.
He can fast push this wave as well and save TP if he wants Zinka, and get TP advantage.
At the time of that fight, so definitely not in a auto great Q, position
boom,
to force
easy
it.
Push out.
And they do get punished pretty heavily here.
Big here as well is that Zeus has a hex tracker.
I haven't, so now I will admit, really one of Faker's weaknesses in the last 5 years, well, the last 2 years, is his lane phase it was a little bit weaker. It wasn't like he would gap you in lane. But it's kind of interesting to see him gap scout in lane.
Is ready to go after you, and LNG should be happy that they're
this
able
is
to
a position where maybe he can save TP.
Yeah, I mean, the Senol helps, sure, but it's not like they were even close to killing back. Anybody. I think that was an ill-advised fight for LNG to take. And honestly, I'm a little bit surprised because they are one of those teams that, to me, is extremely measured. They're usually really good at evaluating
wait, what is
how
Faker building?
In a game. And if they don't feel that they're in a perfect position, you often just see them play side lanes. They
Kindle
trade
gem?
For plates, they trade for jungle camps, they trade for objectives.
Crown?
One of those LPL teams that is least likely to fight you if they don't feel that they're in an advantageous position. So it is a little bit surprising to see them opting into it. And T1 does punish. And you can see as
Crown.
A result of the gold lead opening up, Faker up over 20 CS, gets a kill.
He's
there,
looking for an ult there, Faker.
Two plates, so the
holy
Orianna
fuck, man. They have
a
herald angle mid.
Gold ahead, and the herald's now get
holy
dropped.
Shit, man.
Down here, only gonna further
he needs to be careful
Faker's
not to lose his flash here.
You can see on the bottom of your screen there. Scout
hey, ulti, 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 ulti.
Now they might just go in for the counterpunch. Scout pulled away, forced to flash out.
Faker held his ult because he knew he had the flash. Oh, he's fine here, Faker. They're choking. LNG is choking. Faker runs this shit. He's your daddy. Oh, Zeus too. Okay.
They're living rent free in the heads of LNG.
It's a fucking diff everywhere.
And usually LNG is the team that is so good about not taking fights that they shouldn't take.
Holy
and
shit.
We'll talk about a topside 1v1 later on.
T1 is blasting them in solo lanes. Well, not top
in?
As much, but
why did Scout go
can you
why did
see how cocky Faker
in,
is? He still has flash. He dodges, runs away from his hero and stands in Jarvanult and hits him. He's fucking bro.
No
what are you guys doing? Leave him alone.
This Orianna, so it wasn't even close. And that is back-to-back fights where LNG really unorganized and really overestimating their point in the game. So let's watch this one more time. Zika starts to take the trade here, has the ulti available, but Zeus just sidestepping on the
holy Zeus movement.
And then is able to turn it around here in the final moments. So both these Qs, actually both players playing it really well, but just
what happened to T1?
Through that ultimate meant couldn't actually do enough
look
damage.
At him.
And I think because of the earlier play,
Fake, Azir has the ultimate away because he's too far. Then he doesn't use his ult because he knows Azir will have to flash.
Yeah, again,
then he runs out of tower range because he knows he's going to ult it. Because
so
they had a ward over Raptor, so he knows Jarvan's there. Ult's on the stun.
Available, you're just never getting out of there.
I mean, yeah.
As Tarzan feels
it's
like
game one, but
Scout and Tarzan just
this
not
is crazy.
It needs to be.
No, absolutely not.
Faker
LNG
still has flash, so now he can still play super cocky.
If you can't tell, the crowd seems to be favoring T1 here in Korea. The crowd erupting with every
don't
single
be a game
play.
On Andy. It won't be a game on Andy.
And LNG
it won't be.
Looking really uncomfortable.
I mean, Gal wanted to turn it into a library. That has not been the case yet. T1 off to a roaring start. 3k gold advantage. Fantastic at the stage
damn.
Of the game. And again, bot lane
all the meanwhile,
bot
lane just chilling and pushing.
Yet. They have done very little. They are a part of the gold lead courtesy of Senna and all that additional soul gold, but they've just kept Gala and Hong under their turret the entire game thus far.
But the big thing is, with a lot of the action happening towards the top side of the map, it has allowed Guma and
Gala
to just play fully.
Yeah, look at the experience involved. Look at
because
Senna Blitzcrank
no
EXP.
Support from Tarzan and Scout and Tick, obviously, I haven't had an opportunity yet either to get
ah,
to the
owner
top
lane
side
gang
of the
top.
Map.
Oh, no way! Owner's lane ganging top, really?
Like,
really? Is he doing that?
What is it?
Is owner lane ganging top again?
Gold lead here, just from the plates on Guma over Gala.
Damn, that's new.
The gold is relevant on Ascena here, and he's a good 600-700 gold ahead because he's actually farming gold as
yeah,
well.
I swear, you know, owner really and Ling getting top.
The crown now done for Faker, so he's going to be staying safe. And
the sexual tension between owner and those top rushes is crazy.
It's gonna be tough. You know, your soul lanes have both
he loves
behind.
Just sitting in those
your
brushes.
Bot lane is perma pushed in. You haven't been able to even. I haven't even seen him attempt a hook 13 minutes into the game so far.
And I mean, look at him, bro. He does this a lot. He loves this shit.
Umbral Glaive. You never are going to know if you're in that safe pocket of vision where you can lurk and set up that perfect hook. The potential is always there, but the windows of opportunity get smaller and smaller when you're at this kind of deficit, when you're playing against so much vision denial, especially against a champion like Senna. And normally, Guma, we often see Collector come out as a first item, aggressive, yes, much more solo queue yeah. focused, but it seems
so
like
they put their bot lane mid, so Faker's swapping bot. Wow, he's going Crown Banshees.
Damage, the
wait, Faker,
that comes through,
when did Faker,
is
V going to Orianna? What is happening?
I mean, you can just see the turret plates, 9-1 for T1. That shows you how that early game is going. They have the kills to back it up as well. Zayas now with that Dustblade complete. He did this all through the LCK playoffs. He loves to play this
Dustblade Aatrox.
Even when he's playing into tanks, he was
what
still
is going
this,
on with these
he was
builds?
Able to really make it work, Chronicler, by finding the backline in these fights.
Well, there's a couple of interesting itemization choices on T1. You already.
I mean, I understand Banshees versus
well
Blitzcrank. I get it.
But it looks like
but Banshees
going
Crown?
Crown into Banshees.
Yeah.
So, like, the man is really going for defensive playstyles in the featured matchup presented by Mercedes-Benz. Thus far, Faker. I
maybe it's because he's so far ahead.
Full supportive builds, but if you're 1500 gold up,
yeah.
I get away with it.
And honestly, I think his read is probably that he's the only one that is vulnerable in these engages. If he feels that, hey, the Neela can stay safe, you know, with the W and the R, and
the Neela can't stay very safe.
You know,
not gonna
lie. All in on Caria, then hey, maybe it's gonna work out.
Forward.
Whoa, nice reaction by Caria.
Caria is clean. TP now coming in just to cover the play in the mid lane, just in case. Crown buff will fade
holy
away,
fuck, Faker is running at them.
Just to ensure that they come out on top in the skirmish will not work out for him.
Also, honestly, it's double AP soul laners, plus it's a Blitzcrank, right? So having that Banshee's Veil actually has incredibly high value, not only against the hard all-ins, but against, you know, even just having that MR is pretty high value. So I agree, people, you know, very, very critical of these really defensive builds, but maybe in this case it works out because you've got a lot of damage on this T1 team.
Zayas is just walking up fearlessly, and this sucks for LNG. This was the guy you set up to pull ahead. The map was split to isolate top lane, but that 1v1 costing so much now as we get later into
ooh,
the game.
They're looking for Faker.
And Zayas, you know, for all his struggles that he has,
I think they can defend this, but Blitzcrank is coming as the pain.
Against Doran, was,
Jarvan
I think, the
E can get Crown off quite
even
easily.
The tough times for T1
he needs cover.
Summer,
okay, he's just running at them. He wants a cannon.
Yeah.
This is, it's really
and he
easy
got it,
to
baby.
Forget that this is a player that has only been the starter for 2 years, right? Like, he's obviously been a mainstay for T1, but hasn't been around for that long.
The whole T1 team, you know, if, well, besides Faker, you know, is incredibly, incredibly young, even for pro standards, but it just feels like they're such veterans because they make
they still
every
have Herald. They
yeah,
just picked it up.
Run, you know,
use it mid for this Drake.
International events,
I think the T1 can sit on
yes,
three Drakes mid-tower down, and they can get bolt here
yet,
one as well from
but
the pressure mid.
Close time and time
it's going to be cooking
and
central
really
in a sec.
And really big now is that LNG is able to create some vision denial against T1, right? You want to have at least an opportunity to maybe try and hook someone in.
And there's no Blitzcrank flash.
With the goal deficit the way it is, I
that's
feel
really
like
big for T1.
LNG is going to be forced to contest for this Drake. Like, Soul
objective
Point Infernal
bounties
Soul is not going to be very fun and interactive
what
to play into.
Hell?
You can see as well that they're already making their way over. And we'll have to see if LNG can find a way, because if they can win a fight here, it might be an avenue back into the game.
It's also Gale Force for Guma, so he's not going Navori. I've seen a lot more Navori in solo queue
yeah.
as well. But going for that Gale Force does give you the additional playmaking. Pros obviously
Caria
really
is
big
two
fan
levels
of this
up.
Item. Allows you to close the gap.
Crazy.
You can see that he is also playing Ghost, so between that, between the flash,
he also has 61
e,
souls at 17 minutes, which
in
is kind of crazy.
Back line, snap people in with the ulti. You have Caria with the ulti over the top to support. And
he's not three levels up. Blitzcrank's about
to
level up.
Massive
amount
of
minion.
AoE damage started off by
three.
Guma. You have Owner going in. You have the Shockwave going in. You have AoE damage coming out from Zayas. And if they can pull off that engage, it's going to be incredibly difficult for LNG, I think, to turn it around.
And I think one thing that LNG needs to consider is we see this all in on the top side. Zayas getting the Q3 in, but not quite as much sustain as
maybe you can turn
expected.
It.
Hex Drinker pocked. Won't result
nope.
in much more. Both sides simply backing away. A trade of ultimates.
There's mid tower. They didn't even have to use Heralds. Wow, they're
three
manning top.
A lot of T1's composition
leveraging oh my god,
they gave away the play very early there. Whoa. Maybe he lives here, Zeus.
TP coming topside.
They're all coming. There's four at top right now.
Full focus on getting this objective.
He's fine, I think. He has to E out the Dravenel. Yeah, he's fine.
Just get the flash in the end. Tower pick up
the
bottom.
They gave away the play so early.
That's going to be double objective bounty in about 30 seconds there for LNG. They got the tier 1 bot. They're taking the tier 1 top. Yes, they're going to be losing that dragon, but they've made the call here. And this is more the LNG that I know that is not going to fight these fights where they think they're disadvantaged, right? And that's why it was so surprising to see them take some of them earlier on. But they're just going to play the map. They're going to try
Faker is power
to get as
farm
much
gold in
the pockets of their carries as possible and attempt to be ready for this soul fight, which is very likely to be game deciding here in 5
like,
minutes.
Look at him.
At the same time, I wouldn't be surprised knowing T1 if they don't even opt into a soul fight.
He has the spirit of Chovy
minutes,
with him.
But just
T1 have like absorbed all the other LCK teams.
That team
owner has the power of
a
like
really long time.
Cousin Peanut combined.
They cooled it down a little bit.
Faker is
didn't really work out quite as well as it has
got
in the past.
Fucking Chovy in his blood.
LNG find a way, because I do agree. I think that fighting there is always going to lose you the game.
Zeus has the power of King and Zaatrox against Gwen. It's the other side now.
And it's going to be crowned into Nashor's here for Scout. So again, respecting the upfront damage, respecting that potential engage. And Zeus just all aboard the lethality train here. He's going more and more towards it.
Wow, Faker is playing really defensive.
Guma, yep. And you know, just looking towards this kind of heavy burst style build. Does make armor very, very valuable when you have three lethality users over on the T1 side, but you know, we're not seeing anything really itemized in towards just yet.
And it's tricky because Ela is an incredibly obnoxious champion. Every bit of crit she buys gives her percentage armor pen as well as healing when she does damage to champions. So oftentimes you'll wonder why
there's
is Ela hitting so hard. It's because to make a melee carry
it's
work,
a very macro
they
game.
Had to give her ridiculous frickin' scaling. And you will feel it at two items, most certainly. You will feel it even more at three items. If this champion is not blown up in a fight, she will take over in extended engages.
There is also the fact that we've seen the most...
Maybe they can make it crash.
One of the most successful combos in this tournament.
Oh, so Banshee's tanks the hit and then Crown doesn't proc.
Combined with Jarvan, right? Like that combo, or Rell and Rakan together. And without the Neela, T1 wouldn't really have anything to outside of a shockwave to really follow up in the same way, and particularly with Guild Force, I think it'll be really easy for Guma to follow up as a good if a good engage is found.
Absolutely, and I even think there's opportunities to just start it off yourself if you do find that angle, right? That's what makes this champion so unique, is that you can be the primary engage, and it's not
Big
really
when you
in a way
base,
that any other AD carry can. Sure, there's champions like Ashe, but it's obviously very different shooting an arrow out versus shooting yourself out.
Sure, and she's also one of the only AD carries in the game that can go, oh, Gwen wants to jump on top of me, that's fine. You know, this is a champion who can block so many of those empowered autos. Yes, she can't block the snip, but can take a lot of these diving champions on head-to-head.
Wait,
he
was fine
like
if he got towards the
guys. Hook going just a little bit wide there, but you can see LNG
Everfrost Blitzcrank inbound.
Fighting tooth and nail to get a little bit of vision down here, just to make sure that T1 cannot attempt to sneak the Baron. T1, no mid cryo yet. But with Guma coming out of the base with Collector, they will start to fight back for some of this vision control.
This is also where you see the Umbral Glaive get a ton of value, right? And the fact that Carrier is able to consistently take away some of the vision of LNG. Although I gotta say, with this ward surviving, I think they still have a pretty good idea of T1 not actually starting the Baron yet.
T1 is really strong. But T1's Baron is not that fast with Neela or Rihanna.
Yep, they do.
Which is good scouting on LNG's part, knowing T1 and
they ideally just want to fight.
Knack for starting Barons on a moment's notice.
Scout here on the side.
Crazy. Level 11 Senna.
A little bit of poke here. Get the Conqueror stacked up against Owner. Blitz. I'm just going to continue to fish for these picks. But Banshee's Veil plus Crown. You know, you talked about it earlier as a build. It's obviously a very conservative
LNG
build,
needs to wait for a second
time,
item on his ear. That guy
no
is piss useless.
It's just not going to happen.
Yeah, it's going to be really tough, especially from the position that T1 are in. And there's so many threats on this team that it's going to be really difficult to get into the back line towards him. But at the same time, you know, you have to respect the fact that Scout is on his ultimate comfort pick, Gala, on
range supports, man.
Is on two items. Scout likely to have his Nashor's done relatively soon. And LNG, I think, are going to hope to get their two items done.
Take a reset
next
here. What does he go third? Void Staff?
Trying to just draw the line in the sand and try to turn this game around. If you can win a big fight there, if you can take that dragon away from T1, maybe knock some of these towers off the map, all of a sudden, the game becomes within reach.
Zonyas? No, he doesn't do that.
And do note as well, talking about two item power spikes, Zay is actually finishing the Edge of Night, another Blitzcrank counter item, right? Yep. Making it hard for him to get hooked in. Owner with the Knight's Vow. which I think he put on Guma just now.
Midge Ice would be psychotic,
really not good poke,
but respectable.
On LNG's side to actually knock off Banshee's Aura tonight.
Gala is even. Yeah, I mean, Gala POV, classic. Team getting just getting into by his team.
30 seconds.
Why is Zeus top? What's he doing?
This is going to be a must-win fight for LNG. Infernal Soul also going to take away a lot of the potential problems.
He's just taking over one wave while Faker resets.
Add all the extra damage on top of that, it's not going to be
he sold Doran's Ring and
or
Faker.
T1,
yeah, Void Staff. Three item Morena. Mamma mia.
All
right, time for a big fight now.
Two items across the board.
Big, big fight.
Just about for the side of LNG. Maybe a chance to fight their way back into this game. Some unforced errors earlier on costing them dearly as we've gotten later into this game.
Does T1 go Nash or do they fight this? I think they should fight
this.
You can see both teams trying to fight for this mid lane wave, but all the vision for T1 is focused towards that Baron side. And T1 do have mid prio. The dragon spawning just now, so will LNG just try to rush it? And the answer is going to be yes. Zika's already on it, and T1 are coming, so the fight is going to be on.
Have to be careful about locking themselves in the pit. Keep your eyes on Guma if he gets to the back line.
Oh, he stole it! It's over. It's the cleanest game ever. Oh, Guma! Yeah, GG. It's a fucking stomp. It's going to be a stomp now. Don't hook him there, buddy. Zeus one-shots both of you. Absolute stomp. Absolute stomp. Holy fuck. Owner stealing objectives. Zeus 1v3ing. Nah, this game's done. This is a stomp game one.
Busan erupts as T1 claim the soul, claim the ace, and claim the Baron. And you have
holy shit.
They've claimed game one as well.
An incredible start to the series from T1.
Hong hooked Aatrox into Q2 on top of Gala. Tarzan choked the smite.
And it only gets better from the moment that Infernal was stolen.
Yeah, they're just not able
Gala
to really
procs his passive.
With this Blitzcrank. I mean, Hong not able to find an angle to engage.
Look at this Zeus,
so
look at this.
On to
he's in a Q1.
This dragon,
watch this hook.
Position as the fight starts, and then Gala just,
just hooked him in to get one shot.
Hong hooks him. He hooks Zeus in. Thanks for the alley-oop. He slams it down on Gala.
And gentlemen, I'm not trying to flame anybody, but I don't think Hong is going to play Blitz again.
It's the self-ban angle.
It might be the self-ban angle.
If you're LNG, what do you do? Yeah, I think
Blitz,
you have to care about Senna.
The beginning of the match, Azil, is very much, it's hit or miss.
Yeah.
And that was
one,
the first hook, Chronicler.
Miss or miss.
Yeah.
That was the first hook. The first hit was a miss.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or a hit if you're a T1 fan.
True. They might want more. They might say, let's run it back.
How is pro?
Would be understandable. But look
Senna
at this
is four levels up.
There, are. The
there is a four
Aatrox
level diff on the support
like
role.
A truck, combined with Anila, combined with Faker.
Senna
even
is such
on
a problem.
Super tanky build, still outputting so much damage. Hook not quite going to connect there onto Owner. He could feel the wind on his backside, but T1 just barreling down the bottom lane.
And honestly, it's just been a tough one for LNG because you lost
bro,
topside
stop
around
saying
these engages
OME,
Herald, around this engage in mid lane. Your bot lane in the 2v2 doesn't really stand much of a chance. Your perma pushed in. So even once this Blitzcrank got out of lane, there wasn't much recourse for him. And T1 on the push. Zeus may be in trouble.
Are we griefing or are we playing good?
Side, but LNG has to be careful about overcommitting. Zeus still just taunting them, teasing them.
Oh my god, Tarzan is running
it. Him, locking him in. They will connect, but he pulls
do you really want to put him in on a Q3? Oh my god. That is what a stump. Hooked him on a Q3.
They make it look effortless.
It's a clean.
Holy fuck.
T1 Baker shockwaves the minions just to speed up the demise of LNG. The Korean fans erupt here as T1 gonna claim game number one.
Jesus.
Busan will not be silenced yet. Incredible start for T1. LNG kicking themselves after that early game, and to be honest, it was a mess there as we got later and later into the game. Going to have to go back to the drawing board as we get ready for game
man,
two.
Man, it's a fisting
and
session.
Coming into this game,
Faker is in the zone.
Me, as I mentioned at the beginning, the most
whole region on his back, that guy just completely
over.
Gapped Scout so fucking
play?
Hard.
And I think it was him and Faker, the combination of the Rell plus the Orianna that ended up being really big. And then also on the flip side, Tarzan in
absolute stone cold killer,
a
man.
Really rough game on the Jarvan. Like, they picked that away, which I think was the right call. But after a game like that, I don't know if you can do that the second time.
I mean, I think he had a bad game, but I also have to criticize Scout. I'm a massive Scout fan, but I don't think he was on point with his engages either. You know, the engage that he went in for
Faker just owned him.
Did not work out. The one around mid lane did not work out either. And LNG have got to calm down, go back to the drawing board, because they just got absolutely rinsed by T1.
And it's super concerning when you look at the elation of those first three picks.
Holy fuck.
How solid that looked for LNG.
I didn't expect that for a game one. I actually thought LNG would take game one, not from draft, but just in general.
Let's talk a little bit more about that game one.
Because T1 takes their time to get into a series.
Put all their faith in Faker and T1, and they have delivered in game one at the very least. They have given everyone hope, I think, because what a shellacking they gave to LNG.
That was a beatdown, Shops. That was actually amazing. And it started in the draft. It was from draft all the way through the game. So well played by them. Massive, massive props here to T1. When all of the pressure is on, the entire country is looking intently at you, and T1 answered.
It does feel a little bit like a Scout after all this time, though, because that is probably some of the worst
after all this time
I've seen that man play in a long, long time.
It felt like one of those movies where the student finally comes up to the master and they're like, all right, I'm ready to take down the master
now.
Yeah,
let's go, let's go.
And then they make mistakes.
Yeah. It was crazy. I mean, it started in the laning phase, right? Exactly. Is that jitters? Mm-hmm. What is that?
It did look like it. I mean,
blaming
so
Tarzan
scouts
for Scout's lane phase?
And
what?
Engages
bro,
were
Scout just
really
got gapped
kind of
in lane. There's nothing
they
wrong with that.
The one where he goes in,
Tarzan inted really hard, yeah, but Scout got gapped in lane.
One over. It was kind of crazy how Faker remained calm the whole time. If you remember back to that Rift Herald fight they're talking about, Faker
bro,
just walks away.
Look at the level 3 trait and tell me that's Tarzan's fault.
And Scout goes in and he whiffs.
And Scout fumbling that cause.
Like, what is he
issues.
Doing?
Like, even in the get-go, that level one, well, we had them where
Scout
had
is griefing Tarzan here.
Tarzan,
now Tarzan feels forced.
Top, had found an advantage by clearing
like, what is this?
Quadrant.
What is
yeah.
that?
And then whatever the hell happened after this, as you can see, just leads to this. I mean, it's a shellacking by T1, but I don't know what the thought process is there.
Yeah, and there's no, like, this is so against what we're
all
used to
seeing. All right, but it's game one. Don't be game one
endies.
Happens like that.
Right? Like, these are, like, obviously, T1, they came out. This is a statement victory for them, but there are also some highly questionable plays coming out of LNG that they did not have to make.
Yeah.
And usually when they get set behind by other teams in the LPL, they play so controlled around, like, turtling for mid to late, and then they try to win in mid to late game team. Fights when they are on better item breakpoints or when they think they can set up. And the only kind of hint of that you saw was that kind of like tier one bot, tier one top trade when they gave up third Drake. But even then, like, this is just a lot of unforced errors from LNG that we're not used to seeing.
And I guess one of the big examples was the Herald fight where you all said, this is weird. Why are
you going for this?
I mean, it is first Herald, which LNG do have a habit of maybe overextending
True.
For, but I do agree. I mean, the fact that Scout's massively far behind.
Yeah, let's see if Tarzan grows into the series if he doesn't.
Which you don't actually want to try and fight on as the Gwen at this point. You don't connect except for the tank in this fight as Scout, and then you've just got no damage actually set up to try
feet?
And clear for
no.
that. It was bizarre that they tried to take that fight after they'd just been set so far behind in the early stages.
And then for that to be followed by the mid lane play that we saw before this was just like, whoa,
it was crazy. They seem out of sorts, right? LNG for now, that's something they're going to have to clean up. Let's take a look at the 24-minute Drake fight, which was the nail in the coffin. I know they were so far ahead, but Owner just walks in and takes it, by the way, even though they had the positioning.
This was so sick. Owner
oh,
goes
the Banshee stopped the hook,
down.
Actually.
Look
it paid off.
Of T1 on the follow-up engage, though.
I think he would be fine
well,
anyway, but still.
Take it, and Guma has bought a stopwatch for this. Goes in on the Neela, shockwaves them himself.
It does feel like, though, when you get to this point in the game as T1, you're actually just untouchable. Mm-hmm. You have the Senna there for the healing. You've got the shield coming through. You've got an Aatrox who's healing for days.
Yeah.
I mean, even Raid of Virtue was on the rail. Like, no one's going to die on this squad when they're that far ahead at this stage. So they're happy to just walk in and take it.
Yeah, and this is where I actually would like to credit T1's red side draft. We've actually seen a lot of really interesting red side drafts coming out after blue side was so heavily favored earlier on in this tournament. And I love
chat,
the
is the screen glitching on stream
rotation.
At all? My OBS
like, we
is glitching
sitting
a bit.
Here calling for her, like, Nila, is it fine? Nila, come on, Kuma, like, you gotta do it. And it was a really good place for it, and it also showcases something that we brought up initially, which is that in this kind of meta that a lot of the other LPL teams have brought to the table with some of these bot lanes, T1 are perfectly capable of playing in it. And you even saw LNG recognize that with the Caitlyn and Renata bans coming out on blue.
It was so smart because it was set up by yesterday. T1, or not yesterday, but when they their last games, when they played BLG, they had two Tahm Kench games. So you think, all right, we're going to counter this Tahm Kench before they even pick it. Blitzcrank, so we could kill his shield and we could pull him in and get two for one. And then they hit you with the Neela. Mm-hmm. Not every team can do this. Neela is a very rare champion, but I remember right when the champ came out,
right.
Guma was one of the
LNG selects blue side. Good choice.
Spammed her in solo queue when very few other players were putting the time, the work, the effort into it. Guma usually put in that work on this champ to be able to have it so ready for this moment.
I actually thought it would be a pick that we saw more often, to be honest. Senna Neela has been really, really strong. We saw it a lot of the Mia Masters. We saw that coming out there.
Yeah,
we
know that some of the
Scouts will play a Kali now.
But no, seriously, it's like something that the teams have been practicing, and I thought we'd see it a lot more sooner. But I think, as you say, it's a great response to a lot of what we're seeing in the meta at the moment, being able to confuse, draw that opportunity to bring out something that's a bit new to the stage. And they performed
maybe, I don't know.
Like, they were destroying the
Tarzan, like, I feel like Tarzan this tournament has had games where he's playing really, really well, or games where he's just absolutely choking. There's never a game where he's just doing fine. So if he just keeps choking, the series is done.
Faker is so cute. Does red side have a higher win rate now? I actually think in knockout stage, red side has a higher win rate, doesn't it?
This will be our biggest adventure.
I think red side has a higher win rate. Where's the jersey? I don't have it.
Bringing
T1 took it.
Roommate to save money, is that the plan?
Say hi to Glenn from
T1
work.
Took it.
Yeah, I think I have a much better plan. We switched to my plan from Verizon.
That is a good plan. Glenn?
Get my plan starting at just $25 when you bring your own phones. Plus, save when you add perks like the Disney bundle. It's your Verizon.
They took it, yeah.
Apple gives you wings.
To sign it from the players or something. Which is going to be Pog. Where's the Monad? Check the Reddit. What's on the Reddit? T1's final boss has arrived.
Right here, they can't drop the ball right now.
I know, it's gonna be so
yeah, but Zeus fun. Falls over here.
It kind of feels poetic in a way that that mantle does fall to...
Wake walking up to 3-0 LNG. What is this? Lots of teasers. Yeah, we're done with teasers. We're done with teasers, we're done with teasers. Yeah, this is all teasers. TikTok T1 hype train edit. What is this? Okay. I don't know. How Busan Stadium is seeing T1 right now. Possibly the greatest quote of the day in the Korean community. Faker is not the guy that needs to overcome. The teams of the LPL are the ones who need to overcome Faker. Alright, here's the Reddit if you want to join the Reddit. There's the Reddit. We do daily Reddit checks. There's lots of good memes there. There's lots of funny stuff every day. You can check it out. Small ad break and then we're big pace. If Weibo Gaming plays T1 in the finals, who are you rooting for? I'm rooting for Weibo Gaming. I will root for Weibo Gaming over everyone. Nothing personal. Nothing personal. Although eating dinner here, or like streaming from here, it's gonna be rough if Weibo win. Listen, T1, it's nothing personal. It's nothing personal. Why is this I'm about to get fired song playing at the same time? I'm not gonna get fired. Everything's fine. Already fired. I'm not fired. Alright, big pace time.
La 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 la.
Run ads? They already ran. Ads are done. What team do you think the Shy will go to next year?
Scout on the flank, however, gonna look
I have a feeling that the Shy is going to retire. I don't know why. And I hope he doesn't.
The Herald still connects. Now Faker going to be in trouble. But again, there's no follow-up damage here. Orianna just sitting pretty. Thank you very much, Tarzan. That was terrible. And now what the hell? T1! Forward dragon soul.
I really hope they don't.
And now it's Kuma Yushi looking to tear through the entire team. Zeyu stands strong on the backside of the fight, taking down so many members on the side of LNG. Welcome back to Worlds 2023, where we are heading into game two between LNG and T1. And
he's quite young to retire at 23.
Literally 5 seconds ago.
Yeah, but he's so fucking close. Rich. That guy owns so many businesses.
Which for Chronicler feels good. He's trying to contain himself. He doesn't want to get excited as an LCK representative, and I understand why. And I think for LNG and LNG fans, kind of just praying for a reset. Just start over. That one didn't count. Show us a little bit more, because there were so many small individual mistakes that regardless of what happened in draft, you could draft all you want, but if you're just going to leave the new Orianna with no damage,
do they care about Senna?
Have a good time.
Yeah, there are a couple of questions.
Ooh, Jarvan Ben.
I think the Senna, at least in second rotation, should get taken away. I think T1 are very happy to use the flexibility that it provides.
Azir Ben.
We do actually see a really big pivot here. This is looking to me
they're
like
self-benning.
A T1 Orianna angle. Jarvan
it's
and
first
Azir
pick Orianna.
Both taken away right from the get-go.
And LNG are
but
on
Caitlyn's
side,
open.
So it's obviously going to be a bit of a
they should ban Orianna, I think. Just swap it up, ban Orianna. Then they'll first pick Maokai. And now the question is, do they go Caitlyn 1-2?
Here with that Orianna ban. Maokai would make some sense, but you obviously, if you are playing on blue side,
do you do
Caitlyn? Jace, which is kind of that priority pairing.
How much value do you have on Caitlyn?
If T1 would be
because T1 really liked Rel last game, so Rel is pretty easy, but they don't have Orianna.
Really top level pairings that people hate to give.
Would also be a flex pick for T1. Zeus has actually still plays it top, even though it isn't that popular.
Yeah, Guma Kate, but the thing is, there's Jinx and shit. So I don't think he's going to pick Caitlyn here,
but... Because I think that Gala, individually on the Kai'Sa look great, I don't think he was the problem in that game.
No.
I think it was more so the
now, this next pick will tell everything about T1. What's their next cryo?
Didn't happen. And then come mid-game, like,
with
what
these
was
bends.
He going to do with his team already being so far behind?
I think you're completely correct there. I
Aatrox.
Think we didn't really get to see most of their composition work at all because they fell so far behind in the early
They don't have a Jax ban, though.
Even if Kai'Sa had been able to do something, it just wouldn't have been impactful.
There's no Jax ban.
And level discrepancy we saw.
They could do Jax here.
Aatrox again. Locked in.
For Zika.
Confident to double down on the blind pick, and no reason you shouldn't be. Zeus
was behind.
That pick told nothing. Yeah, it does. Shows how much prior they have on Matrox.
And I think so much of that really came down to this so fight around Harold that went Jace. So bad. You know, Zicko was ahead prior to that. They had the gank. He got the first blood. He had Jace a massive Malachi, CS classic. Advantage. About 20 CS, I believe it was at that time. But that fight goes so bad, it really brought Zayas back in it. And then, of course,
Scout win.
Solo kill from there really took over. It is going to be the Jace.
I think they're
going to
pick full topside here. Normally, when you play Jace Maokai, you play full topside.
To find out where they want to go from here. Do you pick a top laner now?
I think they're going to go Jax, right?
Are you willing to go back towards that
Renekton?
Are you scared off of it after that first game? Renekton, definitely Gwen. A stable pick, but it is going to be Gwen again. And I think it makes sense, right? Like, I don't think you can just completely doubt yourself or your picks after that first game.
Do it.
Because it was so much down to execution, and there were so many errors. You know, you talked about the small errors, but there was also massive ones.
You are
well.
Chad. You Ooh, are my favorite. You're the best. I love you. I love you. It's so int, but it's also so psychotic and possibly could be good that I love him. He's such a degenerate.
My main issue
like, he is mentally ill. Why did he do that?
Is that it does feel like a lot of the game
it's there.
Happen before Gwen truly is like the 1v9 machine that we know she can be. I feel
Nautilus
like
Ben. Now there's the Rakan situation again.
But a lot of games are decided before that, and I think that's where the Renekton to me, even though it does make you very heavy on the AD, could have maybe provided.
Why Silas? They have Maokai.
Might have been able to. I think my attention is naturally drawn
really
to
good.
Lane now because we
if he can
so
survive lane though. It's just if he can survive lane.
Matchups, whereas instead now we have this Jace Silas, a much more explosive, potentially much Renata. More volatile mid lane matchup.
Oh yeah, they banned Renata 1-3, didn't they?
Back in Swiss, like, hey,
so they
like
could have done Kalista Renata, but now they
right
can't,
now
I guess.
Carry the game. Very
I don't know what you pick. Don't you just go Rakan?
I agree, and I think Faker, most people would not have expecting him.
They can't pick Alistar, right? If you pick Rakan here, because you have Silas.
Game, Faker absolutely did. This time, Scout is going to have the agency in the early levels on the Jace to try,
Whoa,
to,
Varus.
Try to punish.
Whoa. Hold up, what are they cooking? Are they going to play like Varus Ashe, Varus Heimer, Varus Karma? They're playing poke bot lane.
You can go on hit, you can go lethality. There's lots of different angles here. I do think they need some consistent DPS, so I
yeah, Varus Tom could work,
AP
I guess.
Or just purely
I mean, they should just go Aphelios.
Guma, would you say it's more likely to be AP?
I think,
I don't
given
know.
How a lot of the LCK teams have been
yeah,
using,
Aphelios is good, though.
Lethality,
Renata's down.
Nautilus
is down.
Available.
I don't know, Aphelios
and
something.
I think that also playing into LNG, there is a lot of threats there. We don't really get to be close up and actually
Lulu maybe is
I
good.
I think if it's like an Ornn or a more of a frontline pick in the top side, maybe. But would expect this to
I don't
be
like Rakan.
Specifically. There is also
I don't like Rakan because they're going into a range support bot. I think they're going to play like Varus Ashe
with a ton of power
into that.
And there is
they're going to play Varus Ashe, Vimus, Varus Heimer. The only time you play a Varus lane is if you're playing Varus Ashe, Varus Heimer.
This is R5
don't do Kalista. Yeah.
This is so
they
funny,
fell into the trap. Don't blind Rakan. They should have blinded Lulu. It would be hard still, but it's so obvious they're going to do double range spot with Varus blind.
We have not been seeing it in a long time. Do you think it's going to be
I told you.
Ashe or the support Varus? Support both Ashe. Of those
range supports are going to be the meta from quarterfinals onwards.
I mean, we'll
I told you.
Go. Again, they have
everyone's going to play range supports.
What lane or who wants to pick what champion, but I feel like LNG have just been consistently on the back foot. Again, the second game they
This is why I think Wukong jungle is really
again,
good.
Using this support counter pick.
The second Renata meta came in and then people were blinding Karma and then you're playing Heimer bot with Kate.
So
it's like it's going to be a Varus Ashe Heimer meta like
double Halo blades
into these melee supports.
Levels, all about the aggression. Really utilizing that power to try to harass someone.
It's risky though.
Down
it's risky.
They can even look for those engages
very, very risky. Okay, remember you can use your tier 1 or your Twitch Prime to avoid ads.
Very easy to track the
you don't have to if you don't want to, but you can avoid ads with crowd. I did cheat a little bit. I looked at their solo queue match history and I saw Gumayushi was spamming Varus. So I kind of expected them to play range supports.
From owner on the rel as well, so
I like to look at people's solo queue accounts.
Pressure already here on how
and I saw that he was playing Varus.
Be able to actually work this.
And this was specifically a type
so,
of
if you're playing Varus, then
one looked monstrously far ahead of everyone else.
It's very likely you're playing range support.
The spring meta, right? When it was all about, and we saw like Caitlyn support, the Varus, the Ashe, right? We basically saw everything.
Yeah, you can use your tier 1 or Twitch Prime to avoid ads.
In the history of bot lane.
Not
the
fun.
Or don't
the
forget, best, you can also press follow for big pace. If you want big pace, you can press follow.
It was every single game, right? Every single game you heal.
All right, focus up. Game two. This is an important one.
Of the wave, and yeah. From that point on, the game becomes very unfun to play for the opponents.
And it is going to be the double hail of blades I was talking about. So they're clearly going to be going all in for that.
Yeah, this is a full push, full poke lane. Now they did this. They played. What was it? They played. Did they play Caitlyn Renata or something?
Slows already coming through. The stun going to connect. The abduct forcing out the W star coming in from Hong. Now walking away, that's the heal you mentioned at level 1, a little sooner than we expected.
Owner needs to play bot side. Owner needs to play bot side. Last time they played this fucking double range bot lane in Swiss stage, Owner didn't path bot. He pathed away from it.
You can also see Gala, knowing how hard this lane is going
to
be.
The development of T1 on playing around bot has been really good. I need to see more of it though. Because they have Maokai, Rakan. This Ashe, Flash W from Maokai or Rakan, they're dead.
Hong had to start with his W level 1, right? Like, yep. One of the big advantages that I think Rakan has gotten, and why his laning phase that used to be one of his weak points has gotten way stronger than it used to be, is because if you hit your
carrier has
whale,
death skin,
you can tank so much of the damage, but now you're basically not going to be able to contest
carrier
this early game at all.
Well, bot's unlaneable.
That's right where they want to be.
So frustrating to play against this volley. Hail Blades now proc'd. Hong supposed to back away, eating two of those autos. Nice bit of gold.
Mid is hard, though.
And remember,
okay,
that you
can
earn
if you dodge stuff like that.
Worlds 2023 drops.
Barrel skin, my bad.
World's emotes, icons.
I was more like DRX skin,
basically. Just like Varus is getting in there right now because Hail of Blades, baby!
Oh my god, it's so unlaneable.
You can't win a trade against it. That's the fun part.
Big here as well as the T1 did place the ward down.
I knew the meta would be range supports. I knew.
So two options. Either T1 need to get the wave in before there is an opportunity to gank, set up some Tribe's Fission, or have Owner path towards the bot side. It looks like
you could see it.
Case, though. They made the read, and Owner now can invade towards top side or look for a gank on scout.
Well, they saw that he had no blue buff. So yeah.
What is Owner doing? This is fucking
int.
I hate
him.
It.
They know that he didn't go up towards that blue, so it's going to be the blue taken away, and Owner could potentially even get the Gromp.
This
as
is
well
disgustingly
and
int.
Really get far ahead. And that Hawkshot, I do believe, actually spotted them. Yeah, you can see the pings over.
But now they can't push and
so
poke them on a tower.
When you get the push here, it's so easy to get.
They're
going to
hit it once
Ash,
or twice, and then now they have to base or something.
All of these bot side
like,
camps, and even some
it's
of the
great
camps,
because
the
Owner gets a lead,
already being
but
done.
I feel like if Owner was here, they could hit
minutes,
more.
And they're likely going to get a plate right now.
They're going to get a plate. Owner's very likely to.
Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe they can just hit the tower, but now they're playing. Look how far back they have to play now. If Owner was there, they could just fist them.
Play for LNG, and they're thinking for something top. This is a clean early game from T1 thus far.
I also think there's a potential double scuttle angle. I think he can do the topside scuttle.
If he was playing
so
a carry jungler,
side,
it's fine,
really
but
for that scuttle. So it could be
turbo gank by Owner.
Instead, the gank looking to force.
Nice try.
Stun comes out on the Shattering
Good
Strike,
flash.
Just a bit of pork.
Yeah, that was necessary from Scout. If he does not early flash there, he's going to get Q flash. He's going to get flinged in. I think he's dead.
Oh, they do spot Tarzan. We'll see if Owner wants to contest here. Zika does have early prio towards the top side, so this does deny the double scuttle. And that's a big win for LNG. Allows
they see Maokai top. That's big. Now they can carry up the fisting bot.
When it comes to farm.
And I think that's the cost of the attempted gank, right? Because he could have just.
I'm so surprised Faker is going this
spawn,
even in this matchup.
He does elect actually go
he is
for
chilling.
This. Tarzan now is hoping that, hey, are Raptors up? Can I actually invade for this? He goes and looks, but Raptors are not there. So there's nothing really for him to take. The scuttle's
he's actually ahead in this matchup.
Owner, and now he can clear back into his bot side, take those three camps, can even look up towards. The Krugs respawn, and you can see the T1 pings on their own Krugs, because they're saying, hey, watch out, Zeus, because this is the one place that Tarzan could look for a gank right now. If he's up by my Krugs, he could be looking for a gank in behind.
Well, no, get spotted there with the sapling going over to the ward, so we see the pings.
Gala's farming really well. I like the boots for potions.
Hung able to take the early beating decently well. There is still a lot of sustain available, though, for Guma. Double
he's being a bit greedy here, Faker. He's going to have to pot or base soon, because this is getting really crazy. He's being really greedy.
He hasn't recalled yet. Scout has, of course, already used his TP back to lane. Potential window here to try to capitalize on. Faker still has the flash available. The healing as well. Can he find a target? He's going to flash back under the tower. Shock blast there. Faker making it out to safety. Scout looking to follow up the healing now coming in.
He's being really greedy.
One, Scout will stand
he's being
strong.
Really greedy and really cocky.
That's huge for LNG and a mistake from Faker steps back.
I think the reason he did that is he thought
away,
he had E up still.
Greed out for it. Owner, though,
Owner can kill him.
Does spot Scout.
What is Scout doing?
Mounted up. The sapling going to slow far. Down enough that Scout can't escape.
I think the reason Faker walked back up there is because he thought he had E chain to cancel Jace Q, but it ran out.
The delay actually means a lot because Scout had already committed his TP prior to that play. So now that there's that big delay, he's gonna lose likely a full wave as Faker is gonna be able to bounce and push this back in.
Yeah, that
and
bounce, that pushing wave is gonna
full cryo for this dragon here, so they're gonna be able to start this up. There's no way Jace
is gonna
join.
Be a bit of a really important a bit of a swing there, not in the world though
was like level 3 when that started off, and if that play doesn't end up working out,
I would love to see Faker E cooldown on that play. They should show like Pro View of Faker. I want to see Pro View of Faker, because for sure he had E up. He wanted E. Look, E here. He has E 2 now, so he's baiting Jace to jump on him. And now he would E 2 him, but he didn't do it. It must have run out. If he had E 2, he would trade 1 for 1.
Look at the gold. It's T1 up gold. When it's 6 minutes, you have a first blood. That is a massive
must
difference
have run out
they
last second.
Overcome just through farm and through the play already on bot side. You can see, look at Gala's position. You know, he had to buy those 4 pots early on, had to use them all in that first kind of cycle of laning phase. And now on the other side, you've got some early lethality picked
can
up.
Can we go
you've
bot side soon?
Early on
after these crux,
Varia,
can we
one of the really nice advantages about actually
mid?
Playing these range supports here is that it's so easy to farm gold.
Look at how far back they have
to
play.
So much more gold as long as
they are scared.
To these autos and to actually
we know where Maokai is, that's great.
So, great early buys for T1
but we could also have our rail bot side.
And I
T1 is using their bot lane push and Ashe
is actually bigger than
to find enemy jungle, but I would love it if we could find owner bot lane.
So much gold just going for consumables. Guma has refillable.
Okay, mid gank is fine, top crab is fine, red buff is fine, but please can we go towards fucking bot side?
Tarzan in the area, but again, the Hawk shot's coming through.
Yeah, also the ward there in the pixel brush actually spotting
Hex slash
him,
over red, do red,
like
and then come bot.
LNG are aware of that, so ward's gonna remain there and continue giving information over. I do think that T1 specifically
but
have
Herald's spawning
been on
in 50 seconds
this,
now.
But especially with these double AD carry comps, which if you haven't watched in spring, used to be all the rage, it's really important you start stacking the
maybe
dragons.
Maybe
I do think
side.
It's a type of comp where once you lose control, you're in trouble.
Oy, 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 oy.
Barely coming through there.
That was really close, and yeah, I agree. You have to really stay ahead because as much as you can kind of really deal
I mean,
a lot of punishment to these
they know exactly
lanes,
where Maokai is.
All of a sudden,
now Maokai's top,
and the
big pace.
Shows up and you get flashed on and you're both dead. Well, there goes your lead, right? So you do have to pay respect to that, but look at Caria. He was wrapping around, wanted to zone Gaul off, so it's going to be at least one more play going T1's way. It's going to be not only pushing Hong back and almost
it's
killing him.
It's working really well,
it's
actually.
Now nearly
maybe I'm wrong. Maybe
the
way they use bot push to distract enemy jungle so owner can steal camps to put Maokai
so
behind is the best play. Because they're still winning in isolation.
Barely avoiding the tiny little kitty cats.
But owner didn't
do they,
know
how do
they
do this Herald
know.
Then?
So he has to back off because Zika's making
exactly.
his way
yes.
over.
In the game
like,
of poker,
risk
they won.
So LNG wants to abandon that lane. They want out.
Unintentionally so, but working nonetheless.
They're full sending a Herald.
Owner's now going to back away.
It's good timing to full send the Herald because Varus based. If Varus didn't base, they could hit this tower, right?
3 CS to 69 now is
69.
You know, going to catch a couple here under the tower. But weren't able to leverage his strength in the previous game. Went wrong.
So Guma's coming to join, but they don't have six on Varus. They don't have ult on Varus yet.
The player's just too good for their own good, you know? If you just weren't looking at the minimap, you could have just stayed on the blue buff and taken it. Wouldn't even know that Zika was easy.
Suffering from success, man.
T1 ideally want to poke them a bit.
See this Herald being set up. T1,
but LNG want to poke them too. Look at Gala. He has purple gun for one auto.
The arrow available. A lot of poke coming down from Scout.
There it is, purple gun.
This is a must win for T1. Zeus isn't here yet.
I don't know if this is a good fight.
Up in the choke. Gala does have 6 and ultimate. Guma waiting over the wall. 1 second left on the chain of corruption. Has it now.
Actually, it's a smite gap, actually. Tarzan has a baby smite. Owner has evolved smite. It's actually unsmiteable for LNG. They can't walk up. LNG is, like, giving it a bit, because I think they realize they don't have the upgraded smite. They can't actually outsmite.
But it is going to be Gala basing, so LNG looking like they're going to bail out of this and just head him down towards bot.
Yeah, they don't have the smite for it.
It's a big wave that's actually crashing, and even with Gala leaving, I think he's going to be too late, unfortunately, to get most of that. That wave's likely going to bounce, so
can delay T1's it, but they can't actually take it.
Sides, I think.
T1 doesn't know this yet, though, so they're not committing fully to the play, especially because with Tarzan and Zika still posturing this aggressively, T1 haven't really caught on. So
I mean, Guma needs to base and run bot soon, or someone needs to run
the
bot.
Side turret as well. Gala, I think, was also sitting
yeah, they don't
on
have a smite upgrade. They're just going
to
give it.
Get a big
nice of them to delay
here.
It. I think if Maokai had evolved smite, they could try a bit more, but,
yeah, but
he's too behind.
Send down, you know, Zeus to answer this if they really want, if they're concerned about plates going down. But he is going to TP back up towards top. Guma and Carry are heading down towards bottom, so I don't think they're going to get much. Maybe one plate here for Gala. Scout gets one plate mid as well, so they're trying to get something back here.
But base and run bot, classic Herald. Punch
around bot lane. If you look at where the Rakan and the Maokai are, they are here waiting
the
to catch
worst part
the
of this whole sequence is Zeus TP top.
This is a situation where T1
that's the bad news. Oh, they're TPing behind bot.
They've called the play out. They've sniffed it out. They see Tarzan. Gala shredding through two plates, but what else?
I don't know if they're going to get a kill here.
Abscond forward, abduct the arrow, hitting Gala. Gonna be able to walk away from
they got Maokai ult though, that's huge.
Stopping the play in its
the Maokai ult is massive.
To three plates on the bottom side.
Health advantage is there though for LNG, and again, I think this is a must get this dragon. 41 Tarzan!
Tarzan in trouble, stolen. Maokai ultimate leaping back.
Wow, he is really scared.
Getting a little push back to safety here, but T1 now priority access to the second Drake.
That's easy Drake.
And even with Faker not hitting a skill shot, just the fact that Tarzan
yeah,
doesn't have his
was mistimed.
Means that LNG doesn't want to risk it.
Wow, T1 are getting everything.
Second Drake going over to T1 as well.
And with no cleanse on Gala, he had to use that down on bot side, the stolen Maokai ult, all of the CC available from Owner. I think Gala would have been a dead man if they tried to fight this one. So
no mana on Jace.
He's going to be pushed back.
You can E him here.
Scout trading with Faker obviously can't continue to chase doesn't down towards that in. Bot side where you know all the T1 members are. And this side lane has just been mostly kind of left alone. Zika and Zayas been battling back and forth. It's basically dead even, a couple CS to separate the two. And we'll have to see, you know, who's going to be able to get that side lane advantage.
Oi!
Step forward, the combo coming through the abduction nice. Of the kitty cats. Once again, forcing out the flash. The snare will connect. But there is no follow-up there. Instead, the Herald immediately going to get
they
dropped.
They could die T1 if the Jace. It's really here. Risky.
Flash in, though. Owner's not happy with just two plates. Scout now going to be in trouble, but they can't quite find the damage. Faker going forward, looking for a bit of revenge. After the first tower dive, he will find the kill on the Scout as the
very
Herald
well played.
Flashes.
It's a great dive
very
from T1
well played.
Owner, no hesitation. Even with Tarzan, I think, handling that very well, trying to block out Faker, keep him from following up.
Very
Faker
well
still
played.
Had the flash, so he flashes in,
nice
finishes
dive.
The kill, gets out, and they get the plates with the crash.
I'm now stepping in, the flash away, the flash to safety, the slows, big Guma.
Just don't
down,
flash, just die.
He
panic cleansed a bit there, Guma.
He will not be able to get anything back. Crucial kill over to Gala.
And really big play
it was a really nice game of chicken there from Hong. He just ulted and ran in a straight line and flashed.
Side, and
but he didn't press W, so Guma cleansed thinking he's getting W'd.
Overextending. It will be
and then he just W'd him afterwards.
Some plates inside, but I'm pretty sure Zika also should be able to get some here towards the bot lane.
And you can see how many summoners that
because obviously what you
want
to do is you want to cleanse flash the second Rakan gets on you, but
both his summoners as well
this was really
retreat,
crazy
so
dive, respect. He wants to time the Q, but the Q actually missed a little bit, I think. Oh no, it did hit. And then he flashes past the 8 Maokai.
But then Faker just flashes in. He's got multiple of those passive autos stored up. And Owner was tanking the tower on the other side. Really well played from the T1 jungler, setting Faker up. And again,
can you cleanse the airborne? No, but you can cleanse the charm and flash the knockup.
Kind of been set up for success.
So you basically get out like nothing happened.
Steal. It's not just the Maokai ult. I do think stealing that Rakan ult is also really, really powerful. So he could have another good one here.
What I do think is important, though, is that when you look at the 5v5 LNG, they are somewhat
behind. We have to be really quick.
5-600 gold, but Cloud Drake isn't the type of Drake where I think this, if this was an Infernal like last game, you'd be looking at it very differently. But T1 does need to maintain control of this map, because once you lose it and you start to actually front to back against Aphelios, Maokai, Gwen, and Rakan, you're going to be in deep trouble.
Well, and so much of it is going to be about the early poke. You know,
it's
how
a bit unfortunate for T1 that it's Cloud
down.
Soul.
You know, Gala is really behind the curve, so if he's actually getting poked down, getting chipped out, it's going to be difficult for him because he's so far away from being able to get towards something like a BT to be able to answer this. You know, your economy has been pushed way back. Of course, that kill he gets on the bot side does help him, but it'll be really heavily down to execution.
Cloud Soul
and
is really good, yeah, but they're playing
well.
Varus Ash.
Not
imagine they had Hextech.
From Faker, but the carry ultimate.
Oi!
Ash arrow. Narrowly dodged away from there. Calm, cool, collected, wrong. I'm going to clear out this wave, and I think it's an excellent call out that this is such a tricky position for LNG to find themselves in. Need to hold on to some semblance of control in this game. Good news is, after that game one, much more controlled game two, at least trading a little bit, trading blow for blow, matching in some circumstances, while
the kill
T1 still
carry,
grabbing more plates, still holding on to a gold lead. LNG at least not making the same mechanical missteps that they did in game one.
What is really important, though, is for LNG to try and hold on to these turrets. As long as that outer ring of turrets remains standing, T1 can't really fully take control, especially once Carrier finishes his Umbral. If you start dropping turrets,
I feel like T1 might lack damage.
Hotly contested for this reason. It becomes a lot harder to actually keep control, and I do think the single target.
Something about their comps telling me they might lack damage.
Really tough to deal with.
Varus poke Varus with a Zhonya Sylas and an Aatrox lethality.
But at least there's no one with a crazy
like it can go wrong really quickly.
This is a very, very even game number two. It's going to be such an exciting one. A lot of pressure, I feel like, on LNG.
It can go wrong really quick.
First game. If you drop the second one in a close one, it becomes incredibly difficult because then you're faced with match point from T1. And T1, wanting to actually, wanting to be able to keep the pressure on, going with such different bot lane strategies. We've seen it move more heavily towards these enchanter lanes.
Bro, the arrows are just flying around the map.
Playing double marksman bot lane down here, and thus far looking incredibly good.
T1 leveraging their priority into the mid lane, the control that someone like a Lethality Varus is going to give you by just piercing, arrowing every wave that comes forward to break mid tier one tower. And I got to say, I agree. It feels like T1 have identified Gala as a big threat, have drafted in a way that stops him from being relevant for so much of the early game, allowing a lot of their other players to really shine.
It's also something that we've seen
Perfect,
in the
yes.
tournament meta, right? And it's been one of the big reasons
Drake
why
and 10.
We
Faker's
saw
taking a base. Gwen's going to push top and try and get top tier 1.
Was able to get such big leads consistently. It's this bot side counter picks as Zeus goes in on Tarzan.
Tarzan comes through with a twisted advance. Zeus getting lower and lower.
That's the problem with Lethality Aatrox. Dies so quick, but looks like he's out.
A little bit of follow-up damage. Zeus coming back in for the extra healing. Double TP now going in. Faker is there. Lockdown coming in. Zeus is going to try to find one. Faker is towing away the ult.
Could Maokai ult here, Faker?
LNG being pushed back.
Look for first targets. Yeah, not the best.
Faker stolen Maokai ultimate. Will connect, but no further fight breaks out.
No flash on Maokai.
Tarzan is incredibly low.
Karia stepping a little bit too far here, but still has the flash.
Wow, Karia's got balls.
Holds onto it, won't even use it.
Gonna be the heal invested instead. T1's still gonna start this up.
It's
Zeus
there.
Does have TP
T1
available.
Get it.
It looks like Soul
Tarzan's
point,
too low with no flash.
Not even 70 minutes in, is gonna go to T1.
Yeah, the initial play looked like it was going LNG's way, but with the first TP coming through, Tarzan had to retreat. They couldn't chase in and try to finish off
Gwen
Zeus.
TP, Jace TP's top to get top tier 1.
Trades back and forth of these summoner
yeah,
spells.
Faker won't get there in time.
Cooldowns. It was Tarzan incredibly low with no flash. You can't walk in as 20% HP Maokai and try to contest this dragon.
The Gwen is getting strong though. Like LNG have really good DPS, T1 have really good like burst.
But still, a soul is a soul and flash move speed is always valuable.
And a downtown arrow.
No, there's nothing happening here.
Might be enough to get Faker in here, Scout. Zooming out to safety just in time. Not quite enough duration on that one.
Thank you, Merc Treads.
Honestly, a crucial purchase against a team with this much upfront CC, with this much.
Oh, Faker.
Potential.
Oh my god, you're so cocky. That movement
there.
Was crazy.
Herald stolen away. Chronicle, you talked
this
about
guy,
how
man.
That one
you're
can
such a.
Break tier 1 mid without its health, but maybe LNG can use it to fire back.
It's a really good counterpunch from LNG because it means that you can probably hold on to both of your outer.
Faker's just running mid. Why?
Longer.
Why isn't he defending top?
T1 also possibly could have leveraged the pressure that the Herald provides into then an advantage in the eventual soul fight in about 4 minutes' time. And we do see T1 continuously looking aggressive.
I think they could have
right
held
now,
that
no
top tier 1 for a bit longer.
Map, right? So they can either try and go and play aggressively towards these sides, send multiple people there and look for a dive opportunity, or try and find individual picks and set up for the dragon when it does come up.
And I mean, you could see how much of an emphasis there was towards the dragon. You know, just look towards the bot side, all of vision there.
Yoinkies.
Now they're getting vision in around that top side.
Bro,
as well.
Rel Q does so much damage for steals.
T1 constantly pushing forward, utilizing Hawkshot, utilizing volley to check brushes, moving around with owner, establishing forward.
T1 just waiting for dragon
to try to kind of move up that line. And even open up opportunities like this, where Faker's pushing in top, Owner and Carrier are going to cover him, and it's likely going to be a tier 1 tower unless LNG are really
problem
willing
is Faker,
to fight for it.
He wants to
for
hit
LNG
it, he can
though,
hit it, but it obviously he's vulnerable when he's hitting it, so...
Hit. They can also just decide
yeah,
to
nice.
Give up control
nice,
of
nice,
the
nice.
Area for now. As long as you don't give over the dragon, I do think that you're going to reach the two item breakpoints. We're seeing that Gala's getting close, same for Zika, and from that point on, one fight can be enough, and I do still think that that is where LNG, if they can actually get that front to back, could look for a turnaround.
I think they can, but I'm really concerned for their ability to. If T1 is first one to that objective, I think we're going to see T1 committing cooldowns really aggressively just to get chunks down on LNG. We're going to see Stolen Maokai ultimate come out right away. We're going to see the ultimates coming out from Karia and Guma. Everyone just committing these resources early in a fight to try to chunk LNG down to a point where they can't get that 100-0 fight, because that is what they're looking for. They're looking for that fight to start, and they just overwhelm their opponents with the engage. But if T1 has you down to half health,
all right, he's
going to
get top wave. He's
going to
have Zhonya's.
Really engage.
They're not going to have Mura mana though.
With Lethality Varus, are just always going to have mid prio first. It's so hard to get your vision down. You will always be responding to the pressure that T1 puts on the map. It's a difficult situation,
God,
and I feel especially for LNG support. Hung, this guy has to be the big playmaker. The Rakan is the one piece of reliable, proactive engage your team has.
All right, big fight
that you
coming.
Can use to shatter kind of the glass.
It's always
the T1 are bringing to the table. But this is a guy who struggled last game.
It's always
a lot to ask from a player when you're already at a single
gonna come
game
down
deficit,
this
and he had such a rough game
fight.
One.
It's also the LNG reason
haven't gotten
why
a single dragon yet.
Silas was actually getting banned a lot. We saw BLG do it very consistently. Because I do think that Maokai loses so much of his power when the opponent can just answer, right? I think Maokai ultimate is one.
Maokai
it's ult. Yeah, it literally is. But it, not only is it a better version of your ult, it also takes away so much of what I think makes the champion so oppressive, allows you to set up shop, and your opponents, particularly with champions like the Jace, oh, try to walk up. They just
he's trying to get a Phidias cleanse before Drake spawn
before they can even get to the objective.
I like the timing of this.
Zika is really strong.
So he shoots out the ultimate. And it's at a time where if
I'm guessing Zeus has a good base
for
time.
This dragon fight, but
Carrier is really fucking
so
scared.
So you do get that flash, but you know your
Carrier was
will
super
be back
scared.
Up as Carrier. And unfortunately for him now, he's going to be missing those summoners, so he's going to be very vulnerable to Hong in this.
And he realized
fight.
He was out
of
position, and Gwen was
the
coming.
The primary target is going to be Guma. They really have to get towards him and try to
stop
take him
saying
out.
Guma, can he see it? Shut up.
Coming through for a lot of people. Scout almost has that tier fully stacked up. Zika's done his second item. It's been
I ain't casting no more.
Slow-paced game in the second game.
What we are seeing here, though, is that LNG, again, identified that T1 doesn't need to go for this dragon. This is just an
good
individual
times.
Drake for them. Obviously, if they
good
get
times.
It, they get soul. But LNG try to set up as much vision as they can to sniff out a Baron in case T1 do not opt into a contest at all. And
what's this public safety message warning on my phone?
Set up, if you take a look,
huh?
One ward on the top half of the map.
It's in Korean.
And these wards
did anyone else get that? What did it say?
Good idea of where T1 is going to go. As it is about 20 seconds until that possible soul spawns.
Umbral Glaive spawning adds a bit of vision, but they still get the information that they need. His second Herald is utilized mid lane. I don't. It's gonna. It should get the charge. Is it gonna get the charge? The Matador in the eyes of the bull.
What?
On that one, Faker off the side.
Oh, Arrow!
Out. Arrow is going to connect, but not onto a priority target. LNG, will they
Owner?
Re-engage? No, just opting to back out. No, that this is not their window to fight.
But again, this is what I expected from T1. Push in, utilize those ultimates.
They need
early,
to poke. Otherwise, this Pharos ain't going
to
do nothing. I think this is the one window where LNG can win a fight.
Position here themselves with Zika on the side. Tarzan will try to retake some of this vision. And LNG are going
to
try to get the scuttle and see
too.
If they can find the better angle for the engage.
Scuttle down.
All right.
Guns for a fight.
I don't think LNG should flip it, but it looks like Gala's murdering Dragon.
But if it just comes down to a poke battle, he will not come out on top. LNG forcing the issue.
Hong doesn't have a good angle to engage at all, though. Like, look where he's playing. He's
what is Gala
like
doing? He's leashing
Zayas,
it for him.
He's
getting his stacks.
Go.
Oh, nice reaction by Gala. Faker's got Zika, though. Oh, Zeus! No flash on Scout. It's Faker time. They don't have smite, but I think they got it. I think Faker and T1 got it. Faker was frying in that fight.
There's not enough damage available, and that's going to be soul for T1.
Zeus got so much done there for T1. The zero.
Zeus zoned them, and Faker was just cooking.
Making all the differences. He comes over the side there, gets right into both
nice.
The carries from LNG. Scout and Gala sent packing. They had to run from him.
That Gwen couldn't move. Look at Faker.
Angle,
he instantly E flash R's onto Gwen. Everfrost WQ bursts
right
him.
Wall,
now Gwen's out. Zeus forces Gala out. Then Faker re-engages on his cooldowns
side.
Onto Gwen.
It's Zika
damn.
Out. It's Hong losing out as Carrier, Guma, and Faker will easily
yeah, Cloud Soul is not the worst.
Two.
It's not the best, but
and
it's pretty good for their champs.
Aatrox. Together with Owner ends
like
up
Aatrox, for example,
2v4, which they win, even though Owner ends up going down.
And the out of combat move speed really helps champs like Ash Pharos.
Zika gets taken down. Hung tries to help him, isn't actually able to get enough done.
Oi!
Arrow
going wide. T1 now setting up for the Baron. You can understand why they are so far ahead. The Cloud Soul, their ultimates always available.
They can always start this just to force the TP from Zika, who is pushing heavily down on that bot side. But T1 want to play it out a little bit more slowly, not going to risk it, so they're just going to have Zayas go down towards bot, look to answer, and continue playing with Pryo through mid. Guma shoves mid, Carrier invades with Owner, it's rinse and repeat
yonkies.
All game long, Faker gets pushed top, then moves down with the team.
No yonkies.
T1 are just playing this out so well through multiple lanes and really limiting the options and opportunities for LNG by constantly tracking them.
Charizard did get blue.
That's a dub.
So that's a win.
You take what you can get.
Step one on the journey to winning
series,
the game
it's not a lot for LNG.
Is the blue. It's been brutal. I was ready for this to be much closer, but to be honest, T1, the way that they've been
T1 JDG, man, it's inevitable.
Playing their hand, playing
T1 JDG is inevitable.
Fantastic, and you saw in that last fight, Gala has two items, perfect guns, and he was not super relevant. Solo, yeah, isolated by this consistent blind pick Aatrox top lane. This champion is becoming a problem.
I'm not cursing shit, shut up.
And it's also with a different build than what we've seen the Aatrox be the strongest with, which I think is really funny. It's similar to what we've seen with Kai'Sa as Zeka tries to contest Vision.
Leveraging the Shroud to try to contest here. Gala with the Infernum ultimate. It can always be a threat, but again, T1 just taking their time.
And I think this build from Zeus.
T1 has shown their hand at range supports.
It's risk versus reward,
I think what they'll
right?
do against JDG if they face them and win this series is they'll just keep Rakan permaban and play range supports. Maybe they'll test the Walters in game one and give Lugia open, but I don't think missing can match carrier on range supports in any world.
This one is the 1v9 or the all your team reports you. It's like you are squishy and you've got to execute perfectly, and so far he's been able to.
And it's T1 that has control of the river and that allows Zeus to just continuously push, because LNG can't actually threaten the Baron here, so they can't really force out a response from the Aatrox there, and now T1 might
Their Baron start
themselves.
Is really bad. T1 can't start Nash. They have Poke, Varus, Sylas. They don't do damage to Baron.
Right now is they have the Maokai. They have the luxury of the Saplings to face-check some of this vision for them.
They're
but
always
the
just going to play Fog.
Is not T1's control around the Baron, it's Zeus. This man just eating CS, eating creeps
didn't
everywhere
get the chicken,
on the
though.
Map, becoming gigantic, while T1 just stall LNG out because they
didn't
know
get
they
the
have
chicken,
to
though.
Be in the area.
And it feels like T1, based on their play, based on their fact that they haven't been starting up this Baron, they just want to play for Elder, I think. At this point, you're delaying this long after you took the soul already, after you already have that advantage. They just want to play around that lower damage objective that's not going to be as risky to start up. The Baron obviously has a lot of inherent risk against a team like this that has that hard engage. So they want to continue controlling vision, limiting the options, and taking only the fights when it really does favor them. T1 are playing almost the style that I expected from LNG coming into this series.
It's slow, it's deliberate, it's controlled.
Gala's strong.
And again, you know, in game one, a little bit more explosive when they
Gala
had
is very
on
strong.
The composition.
If he can get Lord Dominic's
Akuma
finish,
and Karia, the fact that
he's gonna melt that Aatrox.
Vulnerable champions is
that Aatrox has no resistance.
Success.
And I think it's really interesting because, you know, when you look just at the scoreboard, it doesn't seem as
focus
bad,
up. I am focused up. What are you about?
Incredibly one-sided because it's been T1
dictating. T1's only 3K up. I wouldn't get too overconfident yet. They need Rabadons on Faker. Okay, well Aatrox just got surreal. That Jesus Christ, that Aatrox is gonna one-shot everyone. Oh my God.
Coming in, will just miss.
Close.
Through the goalpost. Stolen Maokai ultimate. Now
very close.
Potentially a window of opportunity here for the side of T1. Flash
oh, Tarzan, you're griefing.
Safety. A lot of resources committed. Gwen still on the bottom side of the map. Zika does have TP up and available. Tarzan getting chunked. And LNG not really able to get anything. Just a
Cloud Soul, baby.
And that's a really big win here for T1 not having a Maokai ult available. Mix successing the Baron.
How is
way
Faker
harder.
Just never getting hit by QEs on Jace?
Flash. You can smell the desperation a little bit there. It was a great buffer from Owner. As soon as that flash came in, he's mashing W. Gets that dismount to create some extra space so no one can follow
I think Baron starts
not
bad soon, but Karia's
getting... Now, if it does come down to an objective flip, Tarzan not only doesn't have the ulti, but he's chunked and he has no flash. There's almost no way for him to approach
no flash
and try
on Maokai.
Steal.
Baron start would be good, but T1's going to get really low
so
doing that.
T1 can't start up the Baron without knowledge of LNG. Do know though, Faker is about to hit his death gap. Is about 500 gold away, and that is going to be
maybe they wait
power
for
spike,
maybe they wait for Faker Rabadons.
I don't think
maybe.
They'll be able to get it before the Elder. But if they can stall that a little
yeah,
bit
true.
And play with that, I think it becomes really hard for LNG to win a fight.
I don't think that crab is going to save a lot of grace for much longer, Chronicler. You're right, there's Death Cap coming. There's Elder.
They have double Cyrildas.
The T1 can now set up for because, again, they have permanent mid-priority with this Lethality Varus. LNG are going to do what they can just to set up defensive vision. Just
oh,
to make
Tarzan's
sure
griefing.
Their jungle is safe, already burning two wards.
I thought they were going
to
arrow him there.
Fight for bot lane control to have an angle to walk into the river, but T1 already total control around the.
They just have to be careful for Gala.
Highlighting this, they can't see anything.
Gala
they
is
don't
strong.
Know where anyone is so LNG have to fight through bot, try to push in as a squad, and hope that they can win this fight. Because if you can win this fight, that is the one risk with this strategy that T1 are going for, where they're playing so conservative, where they don't set up the Baron. Because if you lose this flip, if somehow LNG gets
Faker?
The Elder, the game can get turned around.
Definitely.
They're trying to find Zeus.
Fighting with the bot prior that they built
Owner?
Themselves. Need to be careful.
Arrow.
Your owner is not quite going to burn the engage quite yet.
No
just
stopwatch.
Buying time. Zika already using the hourglass. Now trying to back
okay,
away.
Well, that's Ashult down, that's but it's not the end of the world. Ashult's
well.
Super low cooldown. Doesn't matter.
Want to start it? No, they're just trying to play for more cooldowns. Just build up these small
Maokai has to be
advantages.
So careful.
Also, Zeus is looking for a back. Not going to get it, though. And we do see the poke from Scout not landing right now. But Gala
does have both his summoners available and is very healthy, sitting on free.
Nice Ash E. They're trying to play through bot here, LNG.
LDR, so he's really strong.
Poke's not landing from Guma. They're coming from top side of mid. That's top side of blue. Bot,
trying to keep Zeus around.
Carry out, does he see them? Yep, Ash E.
A multi-prong attack,
but owner's there.
Looks like they want to preempt the
owners.
Play.
Owner now stepping in, getting forced backwards. LNG not quite able to secure the blue buff there. Owner using one of the smite charges to get it. Gala trying to force the issue, force the fight.
Ash ults up soon. I think they're waiting for it.
T1 has to be careful about grouping for the Infernum ultimate.
Oh, poke misses. Zeus, don't get caught.
Hong's looking for that angle. They're gonna try to pinch.
Holy fuck!
Zeus.
It's a dance on this fucking blue buff.
Resetting a little bit here.
T1 doesn't want to get flanked. LNG wants to pinch through them.
Battle of poke. Both sides hoping to bait the other one into pressing the trigger. The
charm Hong just
now
choked
coming
it.
Through. Will it be enough to lock down Zeus?
Hong
no
just choked it, and
answer.
So did Scout. They both just choked it so fucking hard, and now Gala's just gonna die for their sins. Yes! Bro, Scout is running it.
It asunder. There is no room left in the fight. T1 will take everything they want in this game too. Hung, alas,
it's over. They're gonna end
mid.
That's it. It's 2-0.
Gonna throw for the end. T1 put LNG in a lose-lose position.
Holy fuck.
Contest for this objective. Elder, just too much power to give over. But T1
Baker is his father.
Running, find the angle.
He is just his father.
Fans in Busan will not force T1 to play over aggressive. They keep their discipline, they remain composed, they close
wow.
out cleanly versus LNG.
It was really clean as well. There was no big mistakes.
Point, a semi-final spot on the line.
No big mistakes. This might just be a clean fucking 3-0.
What a performance from T1 thus far. Dominance in game one.
They just seem like they've got bigger champ pools, better meta read.
Absolute control, start to finish. It never seemed like LNG were the ones driving this game.
It's crazy.
T1 looking so prepared, so practiced coming into this series. And
Faker's
really
got, T1's got the meta nail on the head.
Much closer than it has looked thus far. But LNG especially have had no answers for the T1 bot lane.
What's remarkable is that T1 is playing the control style that LNG
can
has so
LCK,
much success
can
with.
Can T1 beat the LPL
LNG
playoffs? Can they win the LPL playoffs?
T1 consistently coming out
destroying LNG would be a very good start.
After the break, but before
it's crazy,
go,
they destroyed BLG
the
as well already.
Daily teases through the eyes of the Oppo camp.
They destroyed BLG, now they're destroying LNG. All that's left is JDG, and then they've basically beaten every LPL team, except for the Shy, who's gonna stomp them. Bro, the Shy clears. Sorry, T1 fans, the Shy clears. The Shy clears, bro. He does. He just does. Did you just try for you? Yeah, I did. I'm gonna run upstairs quick and get a drink, for a soda from the upstairs. I'll be back in 5 minutes. Bear me one second. Are you gonna stream in the 1 week break of Worlds? Yeah, of course, bro. We're gonna play fucking Song of Nunu. Bear me one second.
Against a king. Seeing against believing. A moment against a moment for the ages. Countless battles one arena, the realm. The only thing capable of powering the game, the stage, the broadcast, and the worldwide spectacle we know and love, aka the Cisco Network.
A new roommate to save money? Is that the plan?
Say hi to Glenn from work.
Yeah, I think I have a much better plan. We switched to my plan from Verizon.
That is a good plan. Glenn?
Get my plan starting at just $25 when you bring your own phones. Plus, save when you add perks like the Disney bundle. It's your Verizon. How do we keep on? Lights flicker from afar. I'd rather stay in.
No more time left to pack it up. On the brink of a brand new age, better buckle up.
La 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 la. Think with this form T1 can beat JDG? Yeah, easy. Yeah, definitely. Alright, let's rock and roll. Look what I got, chat. Cider. Everyone wanna crack it open? Listen. Can they beat Weibo? No, they don't have a chance against Weibo. They can beat JDG, but they can't beat Weibo. La 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 la. But T1 fans, don't get too excited. I know you're excited because the LNG is getting stomped, but we don't get too excited because they still got two more best of fives. What happened last year? Huh? What happened last year? Chill out then. Aware. My ear is blocked and it's really triggering me. It's distracting me so much, my ear being blocked.
Healing as well. Can he find a target? He's going to flash back under the tower. Shock blast there. Baker making it out to safety. Scout looking to fall off the healing now coming in, trying to find the one for one, but Scout will stand strong. Legala getting forced to safety. Chakram's stacked. Zeus can't find the angle, but the shutdown coming through for Faker. T1 taking the fight anyway. Scout giving
check
the
Reddit. Aw, T1 fans love it.
The fans are going crazy
the
already.
T1 fans are big pacing.
Into the Sajik Indoor Gymnasium in Busan today with a mission and to keep up the honor for the LCK. And
big pacing!
Match point already. It went so fast. And to be honest, that game two went so, so fast. It started from
my
the first place.
My ear is blocked as fuck.
Talk me through why T1 was able to get such a good start, especially around that Herald.
Well, we've pulled a pretty cool sequence of events that
illustrates
an issue that is sometimes really hard for casters to communicate, and it is the change of tempo from team to team. So we see T1 send their whole team up here.
Stop
to
screaming!
Rift Herald.
Why?
And fully commit.
What
to
are
this.
You gonna do about it?
But we know that T1 have this in
pinch
mind.
Pinch your nose and blow
a
through
lot
it.
In bottom lane power with two Hail of Blades.
Bro, that just gives me like feels like my head's about to explode.
And
what
so
do you want about?
To stack dragons. So they know that by giving up this Herald, they are then going to give up the priority and the tempo for LNG to be able to push out mid lane and then rotate from mid lane down to bottom lane to get these turret plates.
That made me feel like my head was about to
the
blow up.
The problem is, because T1 know this, they're trying to use these turret plates as bait so that they can then get a better setup for Dragon. They can get cooldowns off of LNG. And so you see the Ash Arrow plus the teleport from Faker to be able to get the Maokai ultimate out, as well as the cleanse here off of Gala and the extra flash from Hung. Then they can rotate over to the Dragon, push out Tarzan here. No flash for him either.
Your scream woke me up. I was falling asleep at work.
Even though they
yeah, good. Wake the fuck up, idiot.
Time up there and give up this turret plate money. They still get more back towards their end win con.
And for LNG,
sleeping at work and while T1 plays. What are you doing? Sleep later.
We need, but then they would get poked out, or they would lose someone, or they'd have to reset. It was always T1 with the right decisions and timing.
Yeah, and I think the big thing here is the thing I loved about T1 is this is a return to form for them, right? Like we talked about how the play style kind of introduced by a lot of the LPL teams starting in Swiss but moving into quarterfinals was this more bot prio. Well, guess what? T1 loves this. This is Caria, I now believe, is 7-1 on.
Oh, my ear got unblocked. Poke.
They love this early bot
I can hear again.
Dominance going
oh,
for
shit.
These pushes. This was such a like reminiscent of their spring performances when they were setting the world's meta, not just the LCK meta, but like dictating what the world was playing. So this is such a comfort zone for T1, and it's great to see them show up and not only kind of evolve that meta further, but also a return to comfort for them.
And I think a huge portion of having that opportunity to play around that bot side so well is because Owner is having a phenomenal series. This guy has consistently got these wards in the early stages and has pathed it so perfectly around.
Bam, bam, bam. Yeah, I don't know what happened to Owner. He got so good randomly.
There was a split map happening in this game. Then he was
like, he was like making a lot of mistakes, and now he's playing like.
To go, okay, I can actually start to protect my bot side. I can start to get these massive leads. I can steal away the blue
this
buff
series versus T1.
Took.
Wait,
he has been so good
wait,
at up. Reading what Tarzan is doing and wait. Punishing LNG every step of the way.
0-1-20. Well, what
yeah,
a team
not
player.
Bad.
I think I have to stress how like out of sorts he looked in
you
summer,
coached owner?
Especially
yeah, I did.
When Faker wasn't there.
I told him to
he was
fucking
kind of
go
the lightning rod for criticism on this T1 team when they were struggling. So to see him come to this world stage and have such a great performance has been awesome.
Faker looks in the zone, and just as a
bro,
reminder,
Faker
T1
is in
at Worlds
the zone.
Has never been eliminated earlier than the semifinals in all of their 7 appearances, and you can see
and
it
they
right
have
now
never
the quarterfinals
been eliminated
Kobe,
by an LPL
they
team.
They are on a different level. They have such clear focus.
I mean, it is twofold. I feel like there has been such heavy priority on these support counter picks and on the jungle diff. Tarzan yep. is not playing very well here on stage. So LNG really need several individual members to step up as well as try and come up with something to deal with this onslaught of bottom lane
listen,
priority that T1 have been in.
T1 will
together,
win Worlds if Weibo gets knocked out.
Yeah, and
but
I think the other
Weibo's not
going to
get knocked out, so T1's not
like,
going to win Worlds.
Only are their drafts good, but their level
the only team that
great.
Can
they
beat T1 is Weibo.
Exactly
I'm telling you.
start the early dragon.
You can say cope. You've said cope about all my takes, all worlds, about Wukong, about range supports, about T1 having the best players for the meta, about Weibo clearing NRG, about Weibo making worlds, about Weibo making knockouts. You've coped me the whole time. Keep coping me. Do it again.
At this point, I am inclined to think yes.
T1 will get to the finals and they'll lose to Weibo. I told you.
All right,
let's see what we got.
But the ultimate question is, can they continue to find these super advantageous bot lanes?
Well, I think the ball is absolutely in LNG's court because T1 is just going to do.
Are they going to ban Azir and Jarvan again? They are.
Okay. They're going to keep blinding the Aatrox. They're going to keep doing all these things that have been working so well for them.
Nico, Azir, Orianna.
To show us that they have a different style.
Change it up.
They can bring out.
Change it up. Rel ban. Good. Good, good. They changed it up.
Winning, they're going to ban off the Rel, so that is one change. Or whether they're
now they should ban Jax or something else. They shouldn't ban. Actually, what can they ban? Is there a good target ban?
There have been errors and issues in all lanes, but
maybe Orianna ban if he has an answer to Azir.
It's been all about bot mostly to me.
This Mauka ban from T1 is really interesting because I feel like the Sidus pick works really well. And yeah, you're
okay. Here comes
into the
here comes a bit. They could do Azir Aatrox. I don't know how much they value Aatrox though.
Which is the Akali counter pick.
Depends on jungle, right? Because there's three jungle bans.
Is the Azir, even though I feel
what's
like
the next best
the
jungler? They could do Vi.
Hasn't actually been that successful as
owner Vi.
Exactly. Yeah, we
what else is owner like? I'm telling you, Wukong is good champ.
The Orianna and actually sweep him back in, which is pretty much the entire idea behind it. But T1 could go towards Akali. We'll see.
It is a safe pick, most certainly. T1 have the luxury of being
Kalista could be an option because Renata's open. They could do Kalista here, Renata here.
I will say, when we were watching a lot of the LCK playoffs the other Chronicler, it did feel like this was one of Faker's picks where he just looked so much better on. Because in the LCK, there was so much jungle attention thrown towards Faker against
Sejuani.
All kinds of different teams. And this is one of those picks
I don't like
where
that.
He not only performing the team fights, but he's able to stay safe in lane, get push. So it is absolutely a comfort pick for Faker. I don't think it's as iconically his
if your name is Cuz, I like Sejuani.
This is absolutely comfort for Faker.
Cool. And yeah, this
what?
Is a 1-2 combo that LCK teams have really
Poppy blind.
Very heavily towards because of the wall Poppy slam that you can get with the Azir. Owner was one of our best Poppies. Was the one who, if I remember correctly, started popularizing it within the LCK
it's
way
a flex,
back.
Yeah, bro. Doesn't matter if it's a fucking
used
flex.
To be the champion that was basically perma-banned against him.
What this
I
does
also one of those
is
really
it stops Rakan blind anywhere
within,
here.
You know, kind of
which is good, I guess.
When you think about what
and it stops
playing,
Vi.
All top laners that are
but they can get Sejuani.
When you think about what Hong has been playing,
they can't blind Jax top either, which they've been banning. Because they can put Poppy top. What does that say? T1 scouts fighting. Bro, which side are you on?
Playing heavily towards top
are side. You high?
To slam Jax here is kind of what I'm expecting. Jax or Renekton play heavily towards top.
Renekton,
if you're going to be
okay.
In that early sedge. So it is going to be the Renekton option.
So they could just pick Aatrox here.
I love Zika's Jax throughout all the LPL, so I kind of want
they could play Poppy
to
top
to
and play Wukong.
I imagine T1 just slam wow. Aatrox here again.
Yeah.
Right?
Like 37% win rate.
Really strong 2v2 that you're going to face. It feels to me like the crux of this game.
They could also do the Zeus classic and just play Gnar. But I prefer Aatrox.
Playing towards bot, and I feel like the Aatrox.
Oh my god, that Renata prio is crazy.
That, the Renata though.
Well, they dropped top. That's Aatrox, man.
I think by either team thus far.
Or it's Kalista, man.
And I love seeing the Renata come out, obviously a super high priority pick. They can now ban away anything they so choose to set up bot lane for success. They still have the luxury of counter pick for somewhere else on the map. Have to see where it's going to go. Poppy could also go into the top side.
I think Kalista, Philios, or...
And that is why we are seeing, you know, Caitlyn banned out these long-range champions. That is what Renata
Kai'Sa?
Struggles into. Renata is really successful into these melee comps, into these short-range comps that are
or
forced
Blitz.
To engage into you. You can answer this pick with long-range, with poke, but Long has not been playing that style. And when you look over at the engage available, and you see an Orianna, you kind of know that they want some sort of pairing with that Orianna that is going to be the hard engage. So I feel like this is very much a read on the first three picks by Carrier, who's saying they
are they going
to
play Draven Renata?
Sort of hard engage pairing that is going to really make this comp bad to play into the Renata.
And I'm wondering if it's going to be the Aatrox ban here, or if they're happy with the power of their 2v2 to let
I think it's a Philios ban.
Anyway. I also really like the Kai'Sa ban there. I think that the biggest power of...
Oi, Gnar. Why? Why? Why ban Gnar?
...has been specifically when the Senna is available with Renata already locked in.
They have so many top champs.
That, so denying Gala...
he can even go Jax, Renekton, he can go Jax, Poppy top, Aatrox.
The best Gnar in the LCK bar none, and T1 have.
I mean,
like,
Zeus Gnar is good. Ash Renata.
Playing around it.
And it's a really good negation pick. It's one of those
Baris
picks
Renata,
that
yeah, I thought
safe.
So.
Doesn't necessarily
Draven's too
to
psycho.
Towards it as heavily, so I do think that makes sense. This is going to be the Varus.
What can you pick bot here?
Though,
you have to pick like a Philios Blitz, Tristana Blitz. Yeah.
Players on the opposite side. I wonder if we do see a transition to the on-hit Varus. It is an
or
option.
Lulu, I guess, could work, but
with Bailout especially, and this is a super oppressive
bot
lane 2v2. LNG, yeah, can build for the
Melio is good, yeah.
Hung outside of engaged supports, this is going to be a tough task. Melio is fantastic. Can outclass the Renata.
All right, well, they took a page out of Weibo's book.
Really
Weibo Goats. You know why Weibo's like going to beat BLG? Because it's range support meta. Don't do J-Stop.
They have no ability to really don't do J-Stop. Be on the front foot. Like, yeah,
don't do J-Stop. Don't do J-Stop. Don't do J-Stop. Hello. Cassante. Hello. Aatrox. Hello. Gregas. Hello. Jax.
The engage options are really, really poor. I do think for LNG. For LNG, I think the early game is going to become so incredibly important. They're going to have
I mean,
to
just
to kind of
he's fucking psychotic.
Engages,
you, bro, the bulls on Zeus are massive. That's a bit of an ego pick, I'm not going
to
lie. That's crazy that he went J-Stop into Sejuani Renekton.
To hope that this keeps Gala
but
safe, keeps
it
Gala
makes sense because they have Varus Jace now, double poke.
I feel like T1, especially with this Jace coming through, can play through sides, can be able to answer, can be able to poke, and
like it's so when he wins Worlds, he can choose a Jace skin. That's what they're using this game for, skin picks.
A short-range composition into Poppy, Azir, and Renata, right? And I do also think that with the limited engage, the only reliable two you have is a Sejuani. Because the Melio is only going to serve as counter engage. It is going to become so hard to play this game if you lose control early on. And when I look at the level of aggression that I'm expecting to come out from T1 when they have played these Jace, Renata, and various compositions, I'd be very worried for LNG.
I am too, and I think we're going to see early Merc treads on the side of T1 when there is not only this Sejuani, but there's also AP in the mid lane.
All right, don't forget you can use your Tier 1 or your Twitch Prime to subscribe to the channel to avoid ads for the entirety of the tournament. I say this every time before we start the game. The pog-offs were flying before I even opened my mouth.
He needs to get active
Zeus, God of Thunder.
With Zika, who is playing press the attack on this Renekton, so it's really all about the early game, it feels like. If they could slam home an advantage up on the top side against Zeus, they can maybe use that to take objectives, maybe use that to snowball the game.
And in the first two games, T1 choked out LNG. Can LNG finally break the formula, find their footing in this game 3? It is do or die for the LPL third seed. Tarzan struggling a bit this series. See if he can do
T1
more
fighting.
Sejuani in the early game.
All right, where we go? Where we go? Where we go? Where we go?
T1 obviously with the entire crowd.
He's playing Jace top like he's so mental.
Of the LCK,
it's crazy because they're playing double ranged bot lane. They want
to
push bot,
right now. They already got three,
but they're vulnerable. But he's playing Jace like.
A miraculous turnaround.
No, I will push top.
Come on, you already got three. Don't get greedy.
Yeah. Having two pushing
anyway,
sides like this is risky to play with.
Connect your League of Legends account with Prime Gaming to grab the exclusive Braum W emo. Can keck along with the rest of us. What the team wants to do.
He said keck.
Sounded like the most hello fellow kids.
Hello fellow kids.
Hey kids, if you'd like to keck along with the rest of us.
I'm in my 30s, could you tell? Ha ha! Anyway, I don't really have a
I'll be in my 30s soon as well.
Okay, it's fine. I think it's a fun emote.
It is.
All right, can scout gap Faker like Faker gap scout?
It's an important distinction.
Yeah.
Great emote.
I'm
but
gonna
I
go get
like,
the emote.
I feel like I have to jump to the defense of Draco's.
Yeah.
Oh, it's true.
We Chronicler, only you're on this. Hurt the ones we love, as they say, you know.
Yeah. Chronicler's on this positivity hype. He keeps showing us this picture of a frog every time we do negative self-talk.
Yeah.
I don't do it. Okay. I won't. Hopefully, LNG aren't doing any negative self-talk either. Got to stay focused. Bot lane again has been a huge. Weak point, a lot because T1 have consistently had the counter pick on the bottom side of the map. Not to
Terry's holding a sweeper, but
mistakes, but
Tongue's on the
winning
second
really
rush because already warded first brush.
First two games,
earlier.
Game 3 going to be a bit of a different story.
And Carry is nice trading by unleashed. Scouts. I mean, if he can play whatever his heart desires, just play for these winning 2v2s, and that's working.
Well,
for
so
T1,
much trading in mid.
And they are such a frightening team.
They're going at it.
Talked about it a lot, but this guy is so versatile. When he really was at his
peak,
it's
scouts.
Kind of
Carry
just
bad.
Going crazy. He was trying all kinds of different supports. He was trying all kinds of
Faker
different styles.
Faker spacing.
And that is where he is
he's
so
scared of getting
incredibly
dove.
Hard to beat because he's so mechanically proficient. He's so flexible as a player, and he really knows how to get the maximum advantage out of these lanes.
Yeah, during the AD carry support meta within the LCK, it was just like you were playing down a ban against
Kay.
T1. There was just no option.
He has top push.
You had to ban Ashe every single time. As Tarzan and Owner are going to meet.
Walking in face to face. Sustained damage. Neither side has that much, but right now a lot of damage coming in for Tarzan.
Owner
we're now just going to zoom his way out to safety. That's the phase
Owner?
Rush. Blocking
okay.
Buckler coming in.
Orianna's coming. Orianna
up with a big old golem here.
Oh my god, he's clean! That was so fucking clean! Whoa! He had a minuscule of a wall! Oh my god, Owner, my goat. Owner.
As Tarzan retreats back, he gets too close to the wall. Owner sees the opportunity.
He's crazy. He is crazy. He is crazy. He is crazy. He is crazy.
But he what is a crazy. Way to assert dominance in a match point game here. Tarzan having a rough series.
He is crazy.
Owner gets right in his face and leaves no question about who the better jungler is today.
And this is coming from the guy who's the big underperformer on this roster.
Yeah.
Azeus.
Stepping in, lots of damage. Zeke can now force a flash out to save.
Zeus is gapping Zika.
Next flash coming in. Poppy gonna try and save the day. Buckler goes in. A little bit of a slow going through. Zeus needs to be careful here. Can't walk too far forward. But Owner.
Almost had ya.
From Owner, everywhere he needs to be.
Man, and Owner is having an amazing world. What happened?
I don't know if Zeus is gonna get his back, but the lane is pushing into Zeus. Tarzan doesn't have flash. Will be able to, at the very least, clear his own jungle, but he's gonna be substantially behind here right from the get-go. And T1 find yet another early game lead.
You used double flash and you didn't even get the Jace's flash. That is, I cannot overstate how bad that is for
you're
the Renekton.
Wow, this matchup looks tough.
You're down 0-2.
Faker's losing it
you
as well.
You just got solo killed in your jungle. Then you both committed flash top to get absolutely nothing into a bad wave state. And now Zeus is going to play crazy aggressive here, knowing...
I don't know what happened to
advantage.
Owner in the last few weeks, but Zika he changed his whole playstyle.
Then you look down to bot lane. Surely it's going well there. Well, bad news. You're getting pushed in, and you're about to lose a play here to Caria and Guma, who have been playing incredible all series long.
Your only strong point of the map was Scout in the mid lane, but that's going to...
Show the replay. I want to see the replay.
Top have priority, giving up so much room for Owner to go wherever he wants.
Maybe he's just been sandbagging all year.
The fact that the early game is already falling apart in a match point situation for LNG again, it just feels like we've seen this game before. We know what comes next.
And it's going to be up to Scout in this one, I think. Tarzan is going to have to farm his way back in the
game. The balls to go for that flash E. You know, if he whiffs that flash E, he's just dead.
And the power over W and Aftershock is insane. But once your cooldowns are used and you don't have that available, and especially if the Poppy can find an angle into the wall, you're not going to be able to withstand the initial burst.
Absolutely. And I just think Owner plays it out so incredibly well. Drops the hammer on him.
Oh, dang.
But damn, that was just so clean. I mean, he gets the aggro on him, uses the buckler. Now they're going to go aggressive bot side.
Bottom side, Owner trying to work.
Be careful, Owner.
Has no mana. Gala finds the initial route. The follow up. Good damage coming through from
Gala. Get phase rush and get out.
Opportunity to turn, but Owner sticking right on top of him. Phase rush now procced. Owner just going to zoom his little butt out to safety.
His little what? His
fine
butt.
For now, LNG holding on in the 3v3, getting pressure here as well. A positive sign for their bot lane, but Owner might look to respond.
Ooh, no hex flash coming through just yet. And N'Gala and Hung both with flashes.
Oh, Faker dashed into him to dodge the shockwave.
Scout had 6 advantage, but he
damn, Faker, you're crazy.
Able to find purchase with it.
Well, and Scout knew as soon as Faker dodges that, he has to retreat because Faker is about to hit 6. And if he stays up trading there, he's going to get scooped back and he's likely going to be dead. So T1 going to use the mid prio. Come down towards the dragon. It's still a big CS advantage for Scout. We haven't really gotten to watch that, but Scout doing a really good job. By far his best performance in the 1v1 throughout the
Owner smites it because he has 2 smite charges, so you'll have smite again when it gets low HP. Just does it faster.
Carry this team, I think, when the rest of the players weren't able to keep it together. Scout always was.
Yeah, I think me coming to the T1 office really made Owner be like, oh shit, I need to play good now, otherwise I'm gonna get replaced.
Advantage. With the Orianna pick that we've seen, can skill insanely well, but not necessarily have the biggest impact. I think we saw this in the KT series as
that's really good.
Is that lead going to be enough with how aggressive T1's playing this early game?
And especially without a great ball delivery system. There's no easy pairing. He doesn't have the Wukong. He doesn't have guaranteed go button that is going to place that ball for him in a fight onto the back line. And that's really what you want. You want that access onto Guma, onto Faker. And I think that is going to be the difficulty for him in this game. It's again, and I feel like a broken record in a lot of these games, it's a bit about the engages here for LNG. They're going to have to come from multiple angles because they don't have any consistent engage. And it's going to be really tough when you're dependent almost entirely on a Sejuani to start off those fights. At
Bolt
this
is
level,
even.
People are so
Minutes
good
losing.
At dodging out.
So yes. T1, really fun early game, but still a very hard game. The game is not even winning yet. The game is even.
If you feel like a broken record, it's because, again, we've seen similar
like the mid pressure right now from Scout is a lot.
even if individuals are laning well, even if Zika was laning well, it didn't matter. Zeus still found so many advantages in the team fight. Scout, even if he's laning well, if he can't press his advantage, if he can't use his advantage, then it does not matter in the face of T1.
The one big difference, though, with this series compared to the previous ones, is that Gala isn't being set behind early. He has actually been able to remain.
Herald starts
in a good
as long as bot can't
the
get dove, but
being
they need to make sure they don't take any bad trades. Varus is 6 soon,
well,
so that's safe.
Actually ends up being big, and I think T1 was still able to stack a lot of the objectives, but it does mean at the very least.
Yeah, if BLG beats. And if Weibo beats BLG, I think they'll win worlds. I'm not even coping. BLG is their hardest matchup. They clear JDG. JDG is way easier for them.
And is going to allow Gala to be.
That's not even cope. If you watch the LPL,
right?
You'll know
you
Weibo can be JDG easy.
With the W, you have the safety and the move speed from the E, and you have.
Okay, here comes bot dive.
That is so valuable.
No six on
the
Johnny.
With the ult,
maybe she gets
to
six
be able
off the pink.
Answer what Carry is going to do, and it's also allowed Gala to play Ghost when generally against Renata you always have
almost
to play
six.
Tarzan looking down here on the bottom side. Good initial damage. Nice pullback on the shockwave. Guma still standing for now. The bailout.
Guma bailout.
Time for them to get one kill back. Tarzan.
Oh, Hung flash ulted, but he missed.
Guma will fall. LNG find an
oh, Renata ult is pretty good. Faker time, baby. Woo!
Knocking two.
And Gala, no one dies. Holy shit, Fleet Footwork and Ghost. Oh, he's a quick boy, isn't he? Oh my god, they're all out. Alright, T1 are back in business. T1 are back in business.
You thought they were screwed as we're going to have potentially a fight here on top side. When Carrier found that angle for the hostile takeover, I thought it was over for LNG on that bot side. Faker came in, but they couldn't quite finish off the kills. And Gala
LNG, sorry, LNG, you're back in business. Sorry, did I say T1?
Running out to safety.
Did Hung hit
and
his flash ult?
Really big here is Carrier at the onset of this play isn't actually six.
I feel like he
so
completely whiffed.
To 100 to 0 Guma. Charizard is crucially able to deny the bailout.
Well.
And because Faker, when he goes in for the shuffle, doesn't actually have any backup damage, there isn't enough, right? He doesn't have the items yet. He doesn't have the burst.
Oh, that creep was 1 HP.
Hung and Gala are able to path towards the top side and dodge owner, who even with the flash doesn't get the wall knock into Gala.
Oh, Carrier flashed as well.
And critically, his Q missed.
No way.
That's why he really ran out of damage here. You can see, you know, proccing that little heal on the auto there from Gala gives him the speed up with the fleet footwork, being able to kite it out, and then the dissonance from Scout gives the additional move speed to really be able to get out of there. So frustrating for T1. And it's a very slight lead, but it is that spark of hope, as you said, Drake.
Yeah, it's a
LNG
hard game. It's a hard game.
Oh,
oh, here to go again.
Return player from Tarzan.
Rinse and repeat, finding the lineup, finding the angle. Instant damage coming through from Felios. They can get the.
Wow, they didn't get the damage to kill. No, Felios ult.
Nice counterpunch coming in from Guma, using the ult to stop the play.
Oh, here comes Felios ult now, though. Guma, be careful.
Desperate to get a little bit more here, but has to be careful. The mark now coming through. Bar is good damage. Guma.
Oh, Guma! Absolute. Cold-blooded. Cold-blooded Guma Susie.
Right,
and we haven't discussed it yet, but Guma Yushi's playing on hit, like, it's not the Lethal Varus, he's playing on hit.
Yeah, Lethal Tempo on hit.
AD Varus, so these longer
Owner.
Fights are so much stronger as they're still fighting.
Owner now trying to
no
make
shockwave.
To safety. No dash is available, so steadfast presence won't
oh, we're going in. He might die for that. No, he's fine. Jesus, man. T1 are going in when I'm like...
Engage will be denied. T1 can just set their sights on the Drake. A bloody back and forth.
They push him out, sure. Tarzan gonna get away, but T1...
They're stressing me out.
...objective right off the back of it. Hung and Gala around, Tarzan...
Oh, TP's coming in, and they just TP'd with Jace, and they backed off. This could be a huge flank by Zika. Oh, no.
Follow-up is there. Owner gonna connect Zika on the backside. Hostile take.
That's a big croco.
Again, there's no clans available for Gala. It stops the play for now. Zika trying to find one. Owner surely should fall here. Still standing because of the bailout, but he will eventually die. LNG get the kill.
That is a big investment, though. Yes, they get the kill.
Jace is milking
dragon,
top tower.
And Zeus is going to have this freeway with the topside turret.
Guys, you're stepping up so far.
For a player. I don't know about that.
Oh, they're both dead here, I think.
Carrier and Guma continuing to back
Guma has ult in three, but they have no TP. They need to stop the wave from crashing, but they can't. It's being proxied.
Faker's on his way.
Ulti available for Tarzan.
Yeah, Faker is sprinting down here.
Down, ticking away.
Yeah, they can't do it.
Faker gonna try to cover early ult to try to make it up.
Oh, they turned it. Is it said Johnny's dead? Maybe.
The
ult. Flash auto. You need it? No, you don't. Double kill for Faker. Too slow on the dive.
CK gets down to the bot lane, and Faker feels like he is on fire in this series, showing up huge for T1, but LNG, they made it way too obvious. The dive was taking way too long, and look at the handshake to set it up.
Yeah, the big thing here is that you can sense the desperation from LNG. They desperately want to try and get a lead somewhere, but especially with hex gates, you need to know the timings. You have so much less time. The wave is so far up, and even with them pulling, trying to get it to crash earlier, it's not
Faker
enough.
Is having an insane day.
And they knew that their opponent saw the dive.
Faker's playing so well.
30 plus seconds. There was a lot of time.
He's down 40 CS though.
You cannot be.
But the rest of the last two games he played well. This lane phase though, he's been getting a bit blasted.
And T1 now, two dragons up, 2,000 gold in the lead, and it's a Hextech soul that is on the table here. Plus a monstrous lead. Azeka has tried,
I think he sacked a lot to cover bot there.
Because
the wave got pushed in and Orianna moved bot, so that's one wave, but yeah.
He's now up over 40 CS. Farmed multiple plates on the
Zeus
top side.
Is destroying. Is now Zeus is ahead because Zika went for the bot dive. He was already ahead by like 15,
that
but
it's gonna be so hard for them to answer.
And the one lead that was still there for LNG was Scout, who has still maintained the CS lead, but because of the kills, I don't think Faker is gonna be substantially behind in his item finishes. Doesn't have a mythic now, but
oh.
Push back, delays because of the crown shockwave, now pulling him back under tower. Faker keeping this one going, trading
against
Scout, the most fed member of the team. Both sides will walk away with their lives.
T1 now looking like they want to play towards this Herald. They have mid prio, they have the vision, and they're going to be starting it up here. There's just no way to contest. You look at the top lane itemization, it is not even close. Zeus monstrously strong, and Zika just still trying to scrape up the gold for his first item.
Doing what they can. Hong can't even clear the vision.
Faker can TP. Scout needs to reset.
He's doing all right.
It's a 4v4, but the Jace has so much prio.
Might step into the area just to try to attempt to steal, but
easy Herald.
It's too late. Again, T1, the ones dictating the pace of the game just as it was.
Faker must have a myth, like
a
Nashor's in base, right?
This time around, but still, they remain in control.
And this makes that third dragon that much harder because T1 are likely to save the Herald. Drop
bro,
it
as LNG had a single objective this game, I feel like they've never had an objective.
Push Tarzan off. They'll secure the top tier one, so they don't even need to use the Herald. Just get a quick reset. Go down towards mid.
One Herald.
Vision through mid, down towards that dragon. Drop the Herald on spawn. Go towards that third dragon.
Got up POV.
LNG have got to decide with
it's
their
rough.
Gear on the line. Do we contest?
And a large
wait.
Part of it goes down back to the
Faker is literally Baus.
Very early on, because I think the strongest part in
what
the early
the fuck?
Game for LNG is specifically that Renekton and Sejuani combo. They literally didn't get to use it at any point.
It's the book build.
Tarzan has been on the back foot right from the get-go, allowing Zeus
the
to
book
play
of Ra.
An isolated 1v1, which with the Jace,
Faker
he's always going to win.
In the darkness, coming through the pushback on
and he ganks
Zeus
top
to
with
the
hex gates.
Dumped down, T1 just running the rift.
Faker is
it's
just
it's from T1. This one quickly getting out of hand as owner going to be chasing down Tarzan. He's got to run. Scout pushing out that tier one bot, but
zooming in. Ulti goes a little bit wide, but the second half of the root on the chain of corruption will catch. Owner wants to keep this 1v1 going. Scout now.
Oh, here's the boys.
In. Stun goes in. The pullback nice
Ansel.
From Scout buying a
bit oh,
of time. And
that ult from owner.
The steadfast presence and who
this game is done, so Faker's dead, but this game is done. That Jace is so far ahead. They just need to secure this dragon, and it's
saving grace there as Faker ends up going
it's
down.
Absolutely.
Even with the flash missed time,
I don't know.
Will end up giving over a kill.
Tarzan is so far behind.
They're still gonna take that play.
The Jace is so far ahead.
Again, the story has been dominance in a way that I just don't think we expected. Even if you favor T1 in the series, I imagine you would think that it was close. But these kind of plays are T1 flexing.
And they're really big is the initial
damn.
Damage that Scout's able to absorb with his crown, right?
It's a shame Faker at tower aggro.
And then the follow-up, the fact that Zeus doesn't actually get to flash the shockwave, but even with that and the fact
it's also
that
crazy that
this
guy's
that
running around with three books.
Able to set up again.
Is Lost Chapter a book?
I feel like, has this happened every single game? Like, free yep. Drakes? This early on is Tarzan?
Tarzan! That's your side of the rift, Zeus.
Oh,
back
wait.
Away, Gala off to the side. He can root up two.
Oh,
Otto's there. Roots.
Oh,
goes.
That Renata ult was crazy. Oh, get him, boys!
LNG, the fight instantly.
Watch out for the shockwave, though.
Carry him,
he doesn't have it.
Get the damage. It is not enough.
Oh, Faker! So oh, we
he wants to wrap behind them. Look at mid. Mid, they're gonna try to get both towers. They'll prevent the charge on the tier one by killing it off. So they're gonna push in that Herald and go for two towers.
The tempo is absolutely skewed.
The delay there from T1. They get a kill. They take two towers. They're gonna get a third charge mid as well.
Maybe Faker can milk it here.
Hextech Drake. With all that going on as
Jesus.
Well.
Soul point oh again. My God.
At 18 minutes with a Hextech Soul.
And most of these games have been about T1 being one step ahead. And now it feels like they're three steps ahead. They're getting three objectives for every one thing
T1.
And it initially looked okay. A beautiful ultimate from Caria stopped that play completely. Again, no cleanse on Gala. Took the Ghost. Wanted more mobility to stay away from champions like Poppy.
I announced that the Dade Award goes to Tarzan.
I just want to... The gold lead right now on top lane is almost 4,000. It's like 3,500 gold in favor of Zeus. So no one
Chovy.
Can match
nah,
this
Chovy
Jinx.
Had a couple so good games. Tarzan has had the worst tournament lanes. Ever.
And
like, this guy is...
Why the top side play doesn't work. T1 are very aware of where everyone of LNG is at the map at any given point.
And we have seen these kind of compositions really struggle time and time again. When you don't have a lot of engage options, there's just nothing you can do when you fall behind. And that is the position that LNG are now in. So they're going to have to get creative. They're going to have to find picks. They're going to have to find a miracle. But T1 have been so bulletproof in their advancement of the game.
That's a pick. Overstaying. We'll get cut down here.
Is God on T1's side? What is going on?
You can't even get the face-checking support. Oh, it just hurts so much for LNG. Nothing going their way.
LNG cannot get lucky. Not
Gala's pissed.
Again. Now desperation strikes in the mid lane, just trying to get something back. That's Gala's Ghost gone. For LNG, every play now, every major move on the map is a gamble because T1.
No way is LNG out of world just like that. Three quick blasts by T1. T1 2-0'd BLG super convincingly, and now they're destroying LNG. T1 counters the LPL. I don't get it. They literally just own the LPL.
As Caria walks away with 50 HP on that pick.
But this is a problem. Right now as LNG, you have a losing side lane. So what you want to do is try and force an advantageous 4v4. But how are you gonna force?
It's
right?
Just
you're
JDG that's left.
Playing into his ear. You have no
and
engage.
Honor goes in. And he goes right back out. Vase Rush Poppy nigh untouchable.
The crown has been popped and T1 are starting the Baron. LNG, your year is on the line right here, right now. How do they get in?
Can they make it work? Tarzan stepping forward, frontlining. The handshake pulls them back. The Baron already gone. There's no fight.
Oh, Owner.
Still, Owner goes in, finds the knock.
No flash.
The back line. They're just forced to back away. But again, discipline is the story for T1. They got what they came for, and they walk away.
T1 get everything. They get the TP off Sick again.
They're going to lose mid tier 1, but it's fine. Zeus doesn't have TP, though. Zeus should just keep pushing. Just get top tier 2.
Hostile takeover. Shockwave there. Hostile takeover. A little bit of damage here.
They're playing 3v5. Guma's not really here. He's arriving now, but he can't really do anything. They're just getting top tier 2.
Zeus is just pushing in the top side of the map. That's their most fat member. He's not even there.
And this is just dominance from T1.
This Guma build is on hit.
More and more
I'm surprised.
They were a bit slow in some of those other games, taking control, steady again, not getting over.
But with Renata, I guess it makes sense.
Is nigh insurmountable. They've got three Drakes in a minute. They will have Soul, and those LNG can stop them.
Nah, Zeus is.
And it really feels like you poked the giant here. T1 have awakened in the quarterfinals, the last hope of the LCK, and it's looking like a damn good one.
This was
oh, T1 JDG is gonna bang so fucking hard. That is gonna be the ultimate banger.
That,
and I think if missing can't play range supports, they're gonna get blasted by T1.
The team was already struggling. You could tell how much difficulty
they have to permaban Rumble, and bot's gonna get perma counterpicked. So I think JDG is gonna choose red side.
They were the team that was supposed to get it done after Genji got knocked out, and.
Really but this 3-0 like, again, and the fact that they 2-0 BLG sets up the perfect story for JDG versus T1. Yeah. Like,
and
it sets it up
Guma
perfectly.
In his interviews, you know, that time away, giving him the
scripted
space to become the player that he wants to become greater, as now Faker breaking in the mid lane. Again, Tarzan can fish for the pick. They might be able to find it here. Can they get Faker down? The pushback is still there. Faker trying to slide, trying to glide out to safety. The root is there. The damage follow-up is not, however, Caria.
Oh.
The flash in, the handshake on the
Scout was going to flash and kill Faker there. What?
Zeus pushing down the bottom side.
There's no way.
To a Hextech Soul. No.
That save was crazy.
For LNG, this feels like checkmate.
from T1, an incredible series that they have played.
Scout could just flash QW,
LNG,
he's dead.
Looked helpless,
but I guess Faker could flash it.
Any of the plays from T1.
So, I mean, I guess he saved Faker's flash.
And it's Hextech Soul with...
It was cool, but yeah, I think he would live anyway.
Azir with Nashers. And a monster fat Jace!
And Zeus, full confidence play. There's no reason he needs to do that! But he does it
Catch
anyway!
Up.
Zeus puts Zika...
Oh my god!
Over. He's looking to seal the deal.
Can we just take
Another
a second and realize Zeus is seven levels up on Hung?
Zero Jace.
Complete dominance. LNG no longer have the game in their hands. They are praying that T1 slip up, that T1 make a mistake, that T1 are overconfident. Zeus... Maybe that was their opportunity on the bottom side, but Zeus makes it work anyway with his massive gold advantage.
LNG are praying, but God is on T1. And it's Faker leading the team, showing up in this series huge. Outplaying Scout across both game one and two in that lane. And really showcasing his class. And it has been permanent. This would be the eighth semi-finals at Worlds that Faker would advance.
Don't look top items, bro.
Has he been eliminated in the quarterfinals?
Zeus is flying.
And he clearly does not want to let that start today.
And that prestige and pedigree, when he can show up like this, when he hasn't been the center of the story.
LNG are broke. They can't win. There's Hextech Soul against Jace. It's lost, and the Jace is fucking 10-0.
And coming into today, I think there was a very real fear for a lot of fans. This T1 roster has already been under so much pressure. It just comes with playing for T1 as an organization, and particularly given
yeah, with Hextech Soul, Jace is basically 10-0. Like, this guy is ultra fed.
When it comes to actually,
when he gets Spear of Trojan in base with double Hextech Drake, he has the ability haste. He can fire like two blasts through the E. Like, it's just GG. It's crazy how fed this Jace is.
We have four representatives from the same region. But T1, it doesn't look like the pressure's getting him whatsoever.
Wait till he gets the next item. It's absolute fisting sesh.
Inhibitor knocked down. Again, T1 taking their time.
Can he get two through the gates?
They have the waves on their side. They have the soul on their side.
Oh my god, he can still, he can do it already, because, oh my god, it's disgusting. Oh my god. He's playing fucking dodgeball, man. Look! He's playing dodgeball! It's not best. Like, look at this!
Dwindling. JDG on the minds of T1 looking ahead to the semifinals.
I told you, check the damage dealt. I told you, he's 10-0.
Shock blast in a row that this guy has hit. He's monster fed, and he is just having them downloaded.
Connected down to the walls. They are firing up so much damage down.
Go show another one. Oh, Faker.
And it's the God of Thunder.
Where's bro going? Nah, Zeus Jace hits different. Zeus Jace hits different.
Final push now, LNG, one last desperate hold.
He don't miss.
And even as
he don't miss that guy.
LCK team falls away. Faker stays standing. T1 stays standing. The last light of the LCK burns bright. And Busan is ahead to the semifinals.
Holy fuck.
What a setup for semis this is.
Hell yeah, T1.
Because I had faith
Hell yeah.
T1 coming into this series, but I thought that this was going to be a hard-fought battle. But T1, they freed
Damn!
A bunch of
T1 is looking good.
LNG and
the T1 is looking crazy good.
It looks so difficult to answer T1 in draft. They were on point with the draft.
The meta is so good.
They may be the last
oh my
remaining team
God.
LCK, but damn, is it a good one. This team was on fire, absolutely obliterating LNG. And LNG, may I remind you, that went 13 out of 13 possible games against JDG that played them closer than
oh
anyone
my
in the LPL. That many
God.
People, myself included, had ranked as the second best.
What the fuck? It actually lagged for... What? It lagged at the end. Can you believe it?
Team from the LPL, and T1 made it look easy.
T1 did, and every second counts, and thanks to the reliable Cisco network, Faker arriving.
I think it's because the chat was all spamming emotes.
And securing himself a double kill. I mean, you look at this game, an incredible set of plays. We take a look back at this one.
Faker is Scout's daddy. Don't forget that, okay?
how much
Faker is Scout's daddy.
Scout if he was able to get the win here. But don't unfortunately forget that. In this one, not going to be the case. Faker with the timing, able to keep his bot lane alive, and I think that this really
100k rats, yo, much love rats, welcome.
LNG in this series, this is a team that was known for their control, their ability.
Holy
to pick
fuck,
fights.
Faker!
But today,
I'm so ready for JDG versus T1.
And obviously, condolences.
Oh man,
can't be happy with that.
Why does it feel like the magic is back in T1? I don't like it when the magic's back. It makes me believe.
Owner especially to shut down Tarzan.
Good thing Weibo is the anti-mage. But the magic is back. You can see it like sprinkling.
But him dominating.
Faker owning Scout. Faker and T1 versus all the LPL. T1 versus JDG again.
Scout was on fire throughout summer, throughout most of the Swiss stage as well, and I was thinking if there was going to be that massive advantage for LNG, it would be in the mid lane. But
holy
it was Faker
shit.
In games 1 and 2 that made such a massive difference, you know, beating Scout in that 1v1 and Zayas in this final game.
Yep. Can you look at Jace damage dealt?
On the Jace, got ahead early, the mistimed gank there from Zika and Tarzan.
Five
Tarzan
more minutes, he does 60k damage that game.
Him down. And then once they had that flash advantage,
oh, it's so good for Worlds. It's so good for Worlds that T1's still here. If T1 got knocked out, it would be a horror.
7,000 gold ahead of where the Renekton was.
And coming into today, I thought that the jungle matchup was going to be pivotal. I did not expect it to be this one-sided, because I do truly think that as good as Owner played, we also saw some of the continued struggles of Tarzan.
Viewership saved.
High pressure situations, and particularly against
the
T1,
stadium crowd
it's not
saved.
The first time that we've seen this player have such a rough one.
And I think people are going to be so ridiculously excited for T1 JDG. The draft preparations from JDG are going to have to be immaculate, because I don't know if there's really anyone you can practice against that can replicate what Guma and Carrier were doing in the bot lane, the creativity that they brought out, the way that they executed on that to dominate. It pushed Hong
just
onto an
appreciate
enchanter,
Faker.
And
that guy is built different.
Final game.
He is.
They had no recourse once
Faker
they fell down.
Faker is constructed alternatively.
Well, and I think overall, ultimately, as Busan goes absolutely nuts, there's just this level of creativity that you hear about in scrims every year at Worlds that never makes it to stage. But T1 are the team that brought it to stage today.
Just
that make it look good.
Stop the discussion. Stop. Stop this base take that Faker's not the GOAT. Shut your fucking mouth. He is.
The puzzle, the equation.
Stop trying to be different. Stop trying to be based. Just accept reality. It's Faker's world and you're just living in it.
T1 series was my favorite series of the tournament. Like, the level of play was absolutely ridiculous. I love that we get a rematch.
I can't wait to see it, but for now, let's send it down to the stage for an interview with Faker and Gumayushi, with translation provided by G-Sun.
Faker interview.
Thank you very much, guys. We are here joined by Faker and Gumayushi on the side of T1. Congratulations on the win.
Faker 선수, LNG를 3-0으로 잡아내고 4강 진출을 성공하셨습니다.
You just 3-0 LNG. How do you feel?
Too easy. Go on, say it. Too easy.
I had a bit of a feeling that we were going to get 3-0 today, and I think our performance was also on a decent level, so I'm really happy with my team's performance and our team play.
Feeling that we were going to get 3-0'd?
What about you, Gumayushi? We were the only team survived from DLCK, so I was like, we have to win this, and then eventually we got a 3-0 win, so it feels amazing.
Nice.
Faker, just like Gumayushi just mentioned, all three other LCK teams got eliminated already, so you guys were the last hope of the LCK. Did you feel any extra pressure about this? I saw you meditating before the match started. I always try to just focus on the match itself only. So I try my best not to care about the given situations. I only focus on the game.
Holy.
Gumayushi, today you're able to see a lot of unorthodox picks on the bottom lane. Nilla Senna deal and then various Ashe comp as well. It looks like you guys are prioritizing the laning phase a lot. Me and Kyria together performed together for such a long time, so we had a lot of options to opt into. Right now, I don't think we have a set meta at the moment, so we are going to be the trailblazer of the meta, and I'm sure that our choices are correct. And T1 did not lose a single Drake in the series. And with this win, Faker, you are keeping your undefeated record up against LPL teams at Worlds in a best of five series and best of three series. What do you think about that? Maybe that's why also all the fans were expecting more and had high hopes about it, but I don't care about the records and the numbers. I just want to focus on how hard we prepare.
Holy.
T1, they don't lose the LPL. Wonderful. Now, heading on to the semifinals, we have three LPL teams and one last LCK team, and you are going up against JDG, another rematch between you and Roller. You know, Roller has some debts from the MSI, and also I'm gonna make sure that he gets to recall some of the memories from last year. I'm pretty sure Roller is watching this interview right now. Anything you want to say to him? Roller, congratulations on the gold medal from the Asian Games. So I will win the world.
Guma.
What do you think is the most important part heading into the JDG series in the semifinals?
I always
mentioned, even in the Swiss stage, that I really want to go up against JDG as soon as possible. I just want to have a great game together. And I am confident that T1 can win up against JDG. So we will just do as we normally do to prepare for the series and do our best on stage. Guma Yusi, you once mentioned that you and Kyria are the strongest bottom duo at Worlds. What is your mindset for semifinals?
We
will do our best during the preparation to do our best, you know, and show the best at semifinals. And I'll see you guys at Seoul. Lastly, Faker. All the LCK fans were so desperate to see T1 win today. Anything you want to say to the fans? We were able to get a very clean win today at quarterfinals. We will make sure to repeat this at the semifinals as well. Thank you so much for your support.
Bro, Faker so humble.
The interview from Faker Guma Yusi after their victory up against LNG today. And I'm gonna wrap up the interview translation. Thank you.
Faker is so fucking humble.
They are very loud. They've been loud all day. I think they've been keeping it in for 3 days. And then today they just got the scream.
All right, that was great.
Not even 3 hours straight because it was faster than that, but absolute domination. Guma a little bit more cheeky than Faker there. You know, he took it seriously and all that. And Guma saying, well, we don't lose to the LPL, so.
I'm just so glad we got to be here in this audience to experience it, because you could feel it. The whole country is giving all their power to T1, and man, did they slam.
It's crazy.
Yeah. T1, I mean, take all the energy. Bro, it's because Kellen. It's because Kellen gave the energy. It's because of Kellen.
International performances, never finishing lower than the semifinal. Like, that's some people's career highs, to steal something that my friend just tweeted. Another thing I really liked from that interview, though, is Faker touching upon how he was like, we are going to dictate the pace
your shirt
of
away.
The meta from now
yeah,
on.
Yeah, they're bringing it back after semis. Pick. So if they make finals, really you know I'm
going to
wear it.
We are going to dictate this pace. And I feel like we saw that through all of their games, especially their Aphelios answers, because there were so many ranged answers for what Aphelios wants to do. It not only did LNG play poorly, but I thought T1 drafted super well on red side all three times, and then additionally had incredible early game plans.
Chat, you can accept that you just witnessed a fucking murder. That was disgusting.
Renata was still able to come out, and even though we got the answer of the Melio, it didn't matter in the long run. I think T1 have a really, really good grasp of this. And when we started off, the top of the day, we're like, why does the LPL look so good? We're like, well, these teams seem to have a better grasp of what's coming into the meta, but instead,
that
it's actually T1 that are catching
murder.
LNG off.
It is so satisfying to see teams change up the meta. You know,
yep.
when people get
Reddit,
bored of the same stuff getting picked over and over and over, and everyone's going, blue side, so big!
All we need
blue
now is Weibo Gaming.
And T1 slam it, and they use counter pick so yeah. effectively, and Guma said it best on stage when he's talking about, me and Caria have been together for so long, we have so many options, I'm very excited to see what they're going to do for the rest of this tournament.
Yeah, someone who played extremely well as well was played phenomenally was Owner. He's our Oppo player of the series, and especially in terms of the story that we touched on earlier, Emily, in terms of the fact that he's not been having the
Owner
best year.
Or Faker could get it, but
that
both
he
are
was
good.
The one who suffered the most when Faker wasn't there, to have such a statement series today.
Yeah, I mean, I think the big thing with Owner is when I talk about the early game plans they had around these drafts, Owner is at the forefront of that. Like, these level ones they had, the invade that I'm sure we're gonna see upcoming with the Poppy onto Tarzan.
Yeah.
Like, he completely kept Tarzan out of these games right here. This was so smart from him after Tarzan blows everything. Going back in, sorry, I'm losing my voice.
That's all right.
To kill him. And then it can't be understated how, like,
I think JDG versus T1
throughout a lot of
it's gonna break
like,
viewership
really,
records.
Really looked lost. So to see
maybe
him come
if it
and
goes
make
to five games
statement performance today is so good for T1 going
this
forward.
This is like the, this is Riot's like wet dream perfect storyline. It's
it
great
hard to choose today.
I mean, it's
Zeta
everyone's
slammed,
wet dream storyline,
yeah. Yeah.
But
yeah.
for
Kuma
viewership it's the best.
Both slammed, but the lowest expectations were on Owner because he has been so unreliable for this team. And he showed up, and he also slammed. So
he did.
He gets extra credit.
Very nice to know, indeed. Also, that flash, when Caria flashed, I think it was like at the end of the game because Faker was about to die, and it was just, it was all working out, everything. We'll see if it keeps going. Let's take a look at the bracket because T1 is still in a difficult position.
Now, what we need is the Weibo win, the T1 win, and then we get the greatest World Finals you'll ever see in your life. Please, Weibo. Weibo, please.
Now, I think
please,
this was a
I'm begging you, practice
LNG,
anything.
But if you're T1, you're going to be running
cheese
the
fuck out of them.
Going, we're going to take on the world, and if I'm
don't
JDG,
allow them
I'm
to
be
win.
About that.
They're taking on the world. They're just taking on the LPL. The, world is the LPL at this point, and T1 are going to go through all the top teams if they want to win.
If they want to win, we're standing by for an interview with Caria in just a little bit. And a lot of people tweeted a lot of this, but Jat in particular had a great tweet.
I want
said,
crisp on range supports every game.
Semifinals, never lost a best of five to the LPL at Worlds in 8 World Championships, and all the teams left are LPL teams. I mean, you gotta dream. You gotta dare to dream.
I want crisp on range supports every game. I want crisp on Lux. I want crisp on Renata. I want crisp on Nelio Messi. I want crisp on fucking Lulu, Soraka.
Yeah. But like, honestly, like
anything.
They came out and they said, you know, some of their players have said this is the last time we might be together as a roster. We talked about how this roster has come like so close to only fall short at the finish line at international events, and how that's kind of colored their
no
dominance.
Crisp,
that
no crisp Blitzcrank, no
years.
Crisp Nautilus,
and so now,
nothing.
The stage is set, 3 LPL teams, T1, the lone LCK team, on home soil in Korea. It would mean so much for this team to continue forward in this tournament.
But also, if you get the fact that T1 takes down JDG, you have BLG on the opposite side, they've taken down Gen.G.
Man, LNG really disappointed.
For that MSI rematch, I mean, we got this already coming through, like, T1 manhandled BLG at Worlds so far, so that could be such an incredible series if T1 are able to go the distance.
I really expected LNG to do something this series,
yeah,
but they did
kind
nothing.
Of the key, have you improved
they just
enough
got destroyed.
Over the LPL since MSI to, I mean, the stage is set perfectly if you believe that you have done that. I was amiss. It wasn't Caria. It's Gumayushi that is setting up with G-Sun and with Lore in just a little bit, and we can talk about that. He's going to be facing Ruler. He brought it up in the stage interview already.
Were they going to interview Guma again?
Last year, I hope you remember. We're going to ignore MSI for a bit. But it's true. It's going to be such a formidable AD carry matchup as well.
Especially when you look at the drafts that we've seen going into that bot lane at the moment. Like, we got the Ash Virus
ooh,
coming
T1 LNG viewership.
Incredible over the
it's really good.
Course of this. We got the Neela coming through. It even feels like they've got more in the tank, which I'm excited to try and find. It feels like the T1 bot lane are kind of putting a stake as the best bot lane in the tournament right now. especially after a performance like that. And when you're going up against Ruler and missing, that's really going to decide if they're able to take that mantle for
I'm not
tournament.
Playing this week
personally,
again.
Personally, my favorite tournaments are always the
I just
ones
want to see the final
where
interview.
You do have those secret picks held till deep in the tournament. Mm-hmm. You know, everybody remembers SKT and ROX Tigers and the evolution of the support counter picks and the Zyra support coming out and then the Misfortune counter pick mm-hmm. coming to it. Those types of things, the creative way that they can get
I can't play solo queue. I'm waiting
very
for my
end of
account.
A tournament and kind of hold it close that deep into a tournament is what is so exciting. And that's what this T1 team is doing. They're so flexible. They have so many options.
The interview is ready, so Laura and G-Sun are standing by backstage with Gumayushi. It's not ready yet. I've been, that's the second time I've been hoodwinked.
All right, well, I have something to say on Toby's point, so it's fine.
Oh, it is ready. Are you trolling me, production, or is it ready? Are they standing by in the post-game interview?
Yeah, they are. All right, let's see what Guma has to say.
Thank you so much, Shox. We're back here in the interview area with Gumayushi, AD carry of T1. Thank you so much for joining
us.
안녕하세요. 축하드립니다. And congrats to making it to semifinals. I want to mention what happened this week for the LCK. As you were the last bastion of hope representing the LCK here at Worlds, what was your reaction seeing all the teams falling one by one and coming into today knowing that you were the last hope for the region?
우선 가장 먼저 이번 주에 LCK에 일어났던 일들에서 여쭤보고 싶은데요. 사실은 이제 지켜보시면서 정말 매판마다 LCK 팀들이 탈락하는 걸 지켜보시면서 어떤 마음이 드셨는지 그리고 그렇기 때문에 우리가 마지막 희망이다라는 걸 알고 오늘 경기 임하셨는지 좀 어떠셨나요?
일단 젠지 대진표를 보고 나서 젠지와 결승에서 만나고 싶지는 않다 이런 생각을 했었는데 8강에서 이제 LCK 모든 팀들이 떨어질 거라고는 생각을 못해가지고 조금 당황스러웠지만 저희한테는 어떻게 보면은 좀 더 주목받을 수 있는 기회일 수도 있겠다라고 생각을 해가지고 오늘 꼭 이기고 싶다라는 마인드로 준비해왔던 것 같습니다.
Well, yeah, looking at the bracket when it was decided, I was like, oh, I don't want to go up against Gen G at finals. And then I was not expecting to see all the other LCK teams.
He was like, yes, Gen G's knocked out.
In quarter, so I was pretty much flustered. But at the same time, I took it as maybe we can be under the spotlight, you know? Maybe we can get more attention. So I did not want to lose this series, and I'm so happy that we were able to get the win.
And I think it makes sense with the approach you have with the meta so far. And you said on stage that you were the leaders here at Worlds when it comes to understanding the game and how to approach the drafts. And I know that T1 often was criticized for their drafts in international events in the past. Is there anything you've been doing differently this time in the way you prepped, scrims, training and everything compared to the previous international events that you've been playing?
그리고 방금 전 무대 인터뷰에서도 T1이 이제 메타를 좀 개척해 나가는 그런 입장이 될 것이다라고 말씀해 주셨는데요. 오늘도 좀 다양한 픽을 많이 보여주셨습니다. 사실은 이전 국제 대회에서는 T1이 국제 대회에서 준비해온 밴픽 전략 같은 게 좀 아쉽다라는 비판을 듣기도 했는데 이번 월즈는 그럼 준비 과정이나 스크림, 뭐 훈련 과정에서 좀 다른 식으로 가져온 게 있을까요?
그냥 이번 메타가 좀 원딜들이 그냥 다 밸런스가 일정한 것 같아가지고 여러 픽들이 다 나올 수 있었던 것 같고 저희가 워낙에 지금까지 같이 해온 바텀 픽들이 많았기 때문에 그런 데이터들을 이용해가지고 여러 픽들을 시도해보고 이제 실전으로 대입했던 것 같습니다.
I think right now, Worlds meta, especially on the bottom lane, I think all the AD carry picks are pretty much balanced, and even so, we have a lot of options available. We can try many different stuff, and also me and Caria, we have been performing together for such a long time, so that
meta's
means
perfect
we
for T1.
Already tried a lot of different duos on the bottom lane, so we were able to try something more, cook something
literally
more
perfect.
In the practice games, and then we were able to also give it a shot on a competitive match.
And taking a step back, I want to mention the documentary that T1 released this week about you, your career, your past. We knew that your older brother was a pro player as well, but it feels like esports run through your blood in general, with your father also being a video games player.
I did not say the
what
same thing about Gen G. That's
to
a
be
lie.
The last representative of
I
the
did
LCK
not say
here
that.
At Worlds in Korea, but also following the legacy of your family, representing them in the
Maybe I said
stage.
The engage support meta is perfect for Delight. But the way the meta is shifting now, it's perfect for T1 because it's range supports Rumble.
프로게이머로 활동하셨고 또 아버지께서도 게임을 즐겨 하신 걸로 들어왔는데 구마요시의 피에는 정말 e스포츠가 흐르는 것 같습니다. 그렇기 때문에 이번 월즈의 또 LCK의 마지막 남은 대표 팀일 뿐만 아니라 또 이제 가족들의 그런 e스포츠적인 유산을 이어간다는
Innovation.
의미에서 마지막 남은 LCK 팀으로서 지금 각오가 어떠신가요?
이제 또 한국 땅에서 열리는 월즈인데 결승에서 이제 LPL 대전이 나오면은 많은 한국 팬들이 슬퍼할 것 같아서 저희가 꼭 결승에 가서 우승을 해야겠다는 생각이 있습니다.
So Worlds right now is in Korea, and I'm pretty sure our fans are going to be so sad to see LPL versus LPL at finals. So I want to promise that we're going to make it to the finals and make our fans happy and win it all.
And next step, JDG, you versus Roller. You said that you were the best bot lane at Worlds right now. Can you tell our viewers why T1 should be feared in semifinals against JDG?
그럼 말씀하신 것처럼 결승에 가시려면 이제 다음 매치 4강전에서 JDG를 잡아야 하는데요. 또 룰러 선수와의 리매치잖아요. 이제 구마유스 선수가 굉장히 자신 있게 우리가 세계 최고 바텀 듀오다라고 말씀하신 만큼 T1의 바텀 듀오를 두려워해야 되는 이유가 뭐라고 생각하시나요?
저희는 아직 꺼내지 않은 픽들이 많습니다.
We have so many more picks to unfold.
It's going to be interesting to watch. Thank you so much. 인터뷰 감사합니다. 구마유스. Thank you so much, Jisun, as well. And Shox, over to you.
He's polite,
thank
he's a homie.
Thank you so much. Incredible.
I wonder what they've got
G-Sub
up their sleeve. Maybe it's
always,
an Ashflex.
Lovely to hear from Gumayushi. I love it. I mean, Kobe said it already, Ashflex. But in terms of kind of just like, no, we're going to dictate the meta.
Yep.
Whatever that may look like, what
Garrett
makes
Newman,
us...
you down?
Let's see it. What do we got? We got Renata, Senna, Ash, Jin support, Pyke. No more Jin. Tristana. Ashe. Ziggs. Oh, Jesus. It's a red carpet. He got rumble-looted in his match history. He got rumble-looted. Interesting. All right, I told you guys that today's stream is going to be short because